maybe even just a psychological preservation to say, I'm in charge of my life. I didn't get pushed out of my job. I chose to leave that job. I chose to take this path. I chose to, you know, those are ways that we edit our life stories to help us feel good about where we are now, instead of being like, gosh, I was really fucked. I just didn't get the thing that I wanted, and I'm still angry about it.
Yeah, you want a sense of authorship. You want some locus of control over your decisions and the story you tell about who you are. And if you feel like you're capitulating to all of these external forces, then what control do you really have over your life? And yet at the same time, when you think, these were the institutional structures I was up against, what did I expect would happen? Like, this is literally, you know, everyone else who fought those same dragons ended up getting eaten alive. Why did I think when it was my turn that it would be any different?
Right.
Thank you for joining us on another edition of the Watching Atoms podcast. I'm Danny Ladoni. Today's guest is Karen Lemke. She worked at Adams State from 2006 until 2015 as the Director of College Readiness Programs and Developmental Education. In this long-form interview, we discuss her December 2020 blog entry, Getting Run Out of Town, in which she describes her slow and precarious removal from Adams State University, culminating in her position being eliminated in the summer of 2015. She describes in vivid detail the Sword of Damocles above her and the sunk cost beneath her as she trudged through every effort to somehow attain the professional development to continue within a dysfunctional system that was always on the precipice of casting her out, and as it almost inevitably did, in a process that felt like getting run out of town. But this interview goes much deeper, as Karen and I discuss the stories we tell ourselves to protect our systems from restructuring or accountability, the exploitative and colonial underpinnings of higher education, the businessification of academia, the role football in particular plays in creating an unsafe campus environment, how a bad employment situation is like an unhealthy marriage, challenging systems of privilege, confronting the creators of harm rather than focusing solely on consoling their victims, and the process of seeking closure and moving on after a loss of community. So have a listen and give yourself some breaks if you must in this edition of the Watching Atoms podcast.
My name is Karen Lemke. I worked at Adams State from 2006 until 2015. I was hired to teach developmental reading and writing. At the time, we had a developmental education program. Within a year, the interim director of developmental education had left, and I found myself running the program that I had just been hired into, and was the interim director for some time. And then there were some reorganizations that happened, and they actually ended up eliminating that department and reorganized the staffing of that department into the respective departments of English and math. And my role turned into a coordinator role to coordinate first-year programming with other people, and there were a lot of redesigns and reorganizations that were happening over that time after the 2008, which is probably when you and I met, I'm guessing.
We didn't meet until 2011 when I moved back to Alamosa. I think we had mutual friends like Aaron Miltenberger that had tagged you in a video that you weren't in, and that's how I kind of first discovered on Facebook, oh, there's this lady named Karen, and I think at some point there was like a house party or something when I was in town, and that's how we met. And so when I started teaching at Adams State in the summer of 2011, you were already a familiar face to me on campus.
I see. Okay. So I worked at Adams State. I also did a lot of different things in the community. I was on the board for the San Luis Valley Ecosystem Council. I was on the board for the San Luis Valley Local Foods Coalition. And that was a you know, a big part of my life there. And so much so that that's what I ended up writing my dissertation about, was sort of the intersection of Adams State and the Local Foods Coalition.
Well, we will get there when we get there in this conversation. But as you say that, I have a distinct memory as you were getting ready to leave, that someone else in our community mentioned that there would be a significant hole in the community after you left, because of all of the different roles that you served, both on campus and more broadly, as you've described. I'm going to disclose to my audience that we had kind of an extensive pre-conversation about how we got to the point of recording this podcast in January of 2021 about an institution neither of us have worked at since 2015. And so one of the impetuses for that conversation was an article or a blog entry, I guess we describe it as, that you wrote fairly recently called Getting Run Out of Town. Can you talk a little bit about that that story? Maybe you can read from it and then we'll just go from there.
Sure. Yeah. I I was aware of Watching Adams, if I may just kind of put a little context here too. I was aware of this podcast while I was doing my dissertation research in Alamosa. And I was listening to the podcast and reading through the documents that had become available because of the structure of the Watching Adams. But I also felt restricted from citing it directly because of the protections of the Institutional Review Board and the intent of protecting the identity and the anonymity of the university and the people that I was interviewing. And so I ended, I just want to acknowledge that a lot of my thinking in those months that I was there and researching and interviewing and collecting data and creating data through the interview structures, it was also kind of playing in the background in my mind, and continued conversations with people like Megan Smith, who had just recorded a podcast with you in the fall of 2017, which is when I was doing my research. And, you know, continued conversations with you and with others. So this document that we're talking about right now, this Getting Run Out of Town, came because of a trace of a conversation I had had just a little conversation with someone from the Valley who at the end he had sent me an article about beekeeping. I'm still a beekeeper. I'm still mentoring new beekeepers, and so we had a little back and forth when I thanked him for the article, and he had said something, and I'm quoting this from his email: "I had no idea that you felt driven out of town and from the college here, and it makes me sad. I thought you left because it was impossible to finish your degree from here. I know academia is often as cutthroat as business or government, but I didn't know that this is what happened to you. The stories that don't get told, you know, the stories that get elided because of people who leave Adams State, people who leave academia altogether, makes it seem as if the story of Adams State or the story of the people who remain is a unified, coherent whole, when these holes, the holes in the story are not present. And so maybe this is an opportunity for me to kind of fill in, you know, whether anyone cares about it or not at this point. But there was sort of a traumatic chapter of my life thinking about what I'd left behind, grieving what was no longer possible, and kind of recontextualizing and saying, well, you know, when I decided to, at all these different decision points along the way, I was doing the best thing that I knew at the time. And so maybe today is an opportunity to talk more through some of that.
So in a sense, this was a way for you to set the record straight to whomever might be reading,
right,
about the fact that it was not a happy ending. And more than that, it was not a decision on your part to merely leave out of some, you know, career convenience or transition, but that you felt like there was more of an active process to a kind of extirpate you from Adam's state. Can you just talk about what that was like? We'll get into the specifics now. So you had a number of different positions, and there was some shifting going on, after which you were kind of left out on a limb?
Yes. And I arrived on this idea that the title of this blog post is Getting Run Out of Town, which, as you say, sounds much more active, like there's people chasing me.
Yeah, there's pitchforks, things are on fire.
And yes, tar is being heated up, the chickens being plucked for the feathers. And that would have been a very visible, memorable, like, wow, did you see Karen running down Main Street? That's really something I didn't expect to see happen under these circumstances. So, yeah, but as you know, as many things happen, it was an erosion of trust. It was, continuing to show up, well, maybe if I do a little bit more, they'll really recognize my contributions here, and I'll feel accepted and legitimized and secure in my employment.
You just got to prove your worth, Karen. If you sit on one more committee, if you just take on one more project, then they'll see that you're the person for this position and they'll value you.
Exactly. Yes. In part, when I started composing a response to my beekeeping friend, I realized that, it is convenient to say, oh, well, Karen wanted to improve herself. She wanted to get a doctorate, and you can't do that here. Of course, I could have done that there, but I can't do that here now. I couldn't do that in 2015, and it wasn't made easy for me to do that there. And so I saw it was, quote unquote, impossible to finish my degree at a distance, which, of course, having lived through COVID, as we continue to live through COVID, that's not true at all. I could have stayed. And I think back to the precedent that had been set just a year or two before I left in 2015. One of our colleagues was able to teach remotely, go to a university in another state and do the on-site residence for his doctoral coursework, was able to complete his dissertation and continue, didn't lose his status as professor, didn't lose his health insurance, didn't, lose any of his clock of retirement and para and all of those things. And that's what I thought was going to happen for me. But that's not what ended up happening for me.
I sort of want to interject just briefly to say what you've described so far with regard to, oh, you just couldn't get your degree here, so Karen decided to move to go do that. I wonder if those are the kinds of stories that a community tells itself to prevent a deeper kind of introspection into how it exploits and mistreats people. It's just more comfortable to believe that Karen elected to travel and leave on her own accord than it would be to say, wow, after all that Karen did here, we really didn't do well by her. And that might be something we have to think about.
Sure. I think if we want to tie this to current events, I mean, Danny and I are also recording this in a week when the federal Capitol building was invaded by armed people who were encouraged to do that, and we may very well see those people have no consequence. So, and already there are people diminishing or telling themselves the comforting story rather than confronting deeper systemic issues or acknowledging the ways that me too, Karen Lemke, participated in the structures that made it that made higher education inaccessible to people, that made that gave us excuses for why we had such an enormous turnover, particularly of faculty of color, but in general, having almost 100% turnover at this point. And, and I think, Danny, you and I are interesting because of the timing of, I mean, I do think of 2008 as a significant year in terms of Facebook and social media being an organizing structure within higher ed, how early on in Facebook, it was very more or less organized around your university affiliation. Right. And it was important to be able, you know, like it, like when you created a profile, you were saying, I work at Adams State, or I went to Lawrence University, or, you know, whatever you considered your home university, because that was sort of the intent.
There was an institutional affiliation between you and your university and Facebook.
Right. And I'm telling this part of the story because so much turnover has happened since 2008 at Adams State in particular. I mean, in higher ed, I'm sure in general, there's a lot of turnover, but Adams State in particular, that at one point I realized, I think I know more former employees at Adams State than current ones. And if I wanted you know, a project where I interviewed them, or, you know, very much what your podcast is doing is, you know, I mean, it's sort of, and I did write about this in my dissertation too. There is a point where you decide if a relationship is something worth saving. You know, you want to invest more time in trying to get a reciprocal relationship with the university, with a you know, departmental chair or you know, a grant opportunity or something that you think is a two-way street, that they are going to respect the contributions that you are making in such a way that it's reflected in the contributions that come back to you.
I will just say, without going into my story, because it's extensively documented, I understand what you mean about the moment where you feel like your partner, in this case, your, you know, your workplace, is breaking up with you.
Well, or you know, is it worth energy. It? Do we save this marriage? You know, is it, am I doing harm reduction by getting myself out of this abusive situation?
Yeah.
Or am I going to make a difference because they're going to actually listen to me when I point out, you know, wow, this policy is making it difficult for students to be successful. When you know, that happens so many times where I had worked on different initiatives and projects, and you know, if we use this as an outline, this document in front of us as an outline, we can talk in more specifics because I certainly can talk in more specifics. But when I zooming out to a 50,000 foot view, at one point I just realized, you know, I'm trying to fight my way back into an institution that categorically rejected me, that said that developmental education is not important. And you know, for listeners, developmental education is, the way I think of it, it's the kinds of courses and supports that fill the gap between the skill set that kids come with, that students come with, and the skill set that is required for the college level English and math courses.
So if you can't take college level, if you can't perform at the college level in math or in English, your office might be a place students would go to get the resources and support to be able to perform at that level.
Right, right. And even the way that we're describing this has power dynamics, you know, all throughout it. It's the tenured faculty who get to determine whether an incoming student's writing sample is college material, so to speak, or not. Mm-hmm. It is the tenured math faculty who get to decide that an ACT score of 19 is going to be the cutoff, because that enables them to have X number of sections in for the college level instruction and X number of sections for the pre-college or the remedial or the developmental or the you know, there are many different phrases because it is a chimeric shifting, changing type of entity. It's a marginalized population, people who are, so you know, quote unquote, underprepared for college education, over, you know, in every respect are the most marginalized populations. My students were the most diverse ethnically on campus. They were generally from lower socioeconomic standards. Students with disabilities were overwhelmingly in my classes. LGBT students, first generation students. I mean, I had so I was the person who helped Adams State keep track of what a first-generation student means, because prior to a grant opportunity that we had in 2010, we didn't even keep that metric. It wasn't something that was on anyone's radar. And, you know, when we discovered that that was a way to talk about our students, we also realized it's a way that we talk about our faculty, because there were several faculty at Adams State who identified as being first-generation college students. And what a rich connection we were able to make, a mentoring relationship between first-generation college students and their professors who had also been on that path. But at a university like Adams State that already is serving a diverse population and has many students who test into the developmental level of courses, it seems pretty significant to eliminate the developmental education program, which is what happened in 2015. Well, which happened really before I got there, because the person who hired me was an interim director. And, you know, wow, making another connection to current events, people who are in acting positions, interim positions, have limited positional authority within the institution. They are still doing all the work, all the administrating, making sure that, you know, students get enrolled and they get the things that they need, and professors get hired and they get the things that they need, and everyone's coordinating among the different departments and different resources, etc. And to kind of say that that's not an important part, even and in the time that I had left Adams State, they had hired a VP who wanted to make Adams State sort of like the flagship for helping underserved students, for historically underrepresented populations. And within a very short amount of time, that person was out the door, and they were moving towards what, as many colleges have, just sort of eliminating the idea that we have developmental students, because the way you describe a problem leads to the types of solutions that you approach it with. And if you see the problem, if you see the student as a problem, if you think it's problematic that we have students who are too dumb to do college level work, then it makes sense to eliminate those students from being on campus. And if you eliminate the courses, then you don't have those students. And there's this sort of logic of like, well, we can maintain the rigor and our reputation and our brand by diminishing the low-skilled students that want to enroll in our courses, versus the other way of thinking of it is, these are the students that we have. These are the math skills that they need. These are the writing skills that they need. How do we shepherd all of the resources available to us, including these tenured faculty who are paid much more than the adjunct faculty who actually teach the developmental courses? Those people who have expertise, who have PhDs in math, who have PhDs in English, they're not the ones teaching the students who need the most skill development in math and English, and they don't see themselves as being responsible for doing that. So some of the structural problems, to answer a question you may have asked several minutes ago about why people don't want to have a lot of introspection about systemic problems at a university, is because you end up pointing a finger right at yourself for who's responsible around here. Well, if I'm employed by this institution, if I'm getting a paycheck, I have some responsibility, don't I?
I'd like to jump into a story that this reminds me of, because you and I knew each other from our time at Adams State in a number of ways. You took one, if not several, media classes that I taught, and we were involved on various committees and community projects. But we had a very special relationship that began when a number of colleagues who were in the same kind of trap that you're describing, of just trying harder and harder to get absolutely nowhere, decided to form the campus advocacy group. And one of the things that we did as kind of our pilot project was just to try and map out an organizational structure of how decisions are made at Adams State. Do you recall this process?
I do.
Because it was an innocent enough effort, I thought, subversion. On our part to figure out how decisions are made and if the documented channels are not working, how they can be fixed, and if the documented channels are not being followed, how they can be adhered to. And that ended up being such a controversial exercise to just discover the way things were purported to work. We ended up in this situation where, yeah, a lot of people didn't want to find out how those things work because it would implicate them in a number of back channels that they had enjoyed to work around the structures and systems that we were told are the proper channels to solving a problem or addressing an issue. So I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about that kind of the structural implication of trying to solve a specific problem that you might have had in your department or someone else might have had in their department. And when you go to solve the specific problem, you run up against a bigger structural barrier that was put there on purpose to prevent not only you from fixing your problem, but from changing much of anything structurally that might subvert the established channels of power, privilege, and decision making.
Right. Sarah Ahmed writes about complaint and problem, that the person who raises a complaint about an institutional problem, whether it's a racialized or gendered or you know some injustice that one sees, it isn't the attention gets redirected from the problem being described to the complainer. The complainer becomes the problem, and the complainer is the thing that needs to be eliminated. So it sort of inverts that idea of the squeaky wheel gets the grease. Sometimes the squeaky wheel gets shown to the door because it's squeaking so much and it's making it difficult for us to do business as usual.
You've just reminded me of a phrase that I came upon at the time we were going through this with Campus Advocacy Group. I think it originates in Japan, or at least that's the kind of colloquial attribution, which is the nail that sticks out gets hammered down.
Right, right, right.
And so instead of a squeaky wheel that gets greased, you're the nail that's sticking out. And rather than figuring out, oh, well, you know, why is this structure so contorted that this nail is sticking out? Solution is, no. We got to hammer down the nail. So there's a coercive conformity that underlies this notion. So if you could just briefly summarize how you ran out of town. Were there pitchforks involved?
To my knowledge, there were not pitchforks involved. The way that I'm thinking about this story now, and I'm acknowledging that it continues to evolve because I didn't want to see myself as like a victim of a circumstance. I wanted to see myself as having agency and decisions. But one, if I spend some time thinking about the structures that were restricting me and that I was working within, I'm recognizing some of the language that I'll share here. So background, history. In 2007, in 2006, again, I was hired to teach developmental reading and writing. At that time, it was a faculty position. I went through faculty orientation with my, cohort mates, and only one of whom I think is still at Adams State and is no longer in the faculty, has also been reclassified away from a faculty role. And I had a great first teaching year, 2006-2007 school year. My boss at the time, Debbie Cunningham, she had also been hired to teach and ended up running the program and running the tutoring. Her role was the Grizzly Testing and Learning Center, all of the CHAMPS program, which was a kind of course that was required of all athletes. There was a LINCS program, which was a course related to the first year interest groups, first year experience, and then all of the developmental coursework, which 60% of Adams State students took at least one developmental course, which is higher than the state average, at least at the time. And these are old numbers. I haven't looked at what current numbers are, higher than the community college average. It was a very high number of students were were testing into those developmental courses. And she had been hired in such a way that she was in the interim position. They were doing a national search. And I think doing that code word of national search is a way of, you know, we don't want to just give it to this person who's been doing the job for 2 or 3 years, I think at the time. We need to make sure we do a rigorous and fair search that makes sure that we get the right person in this position. Now, of course, there are some interim directors at Adams State that you and I know about who just automatically get grandfathered into the full position without interim. They just get hired to do the job that they've been doing because they've demonstrated that they're capable of it. They meet the minimum requirements, et cetera. That was not determined for in Debbie's case. And so she was required to apply for her job, which also means that you will lose your job if the other person, another more qualified candidate is found. And that's, extremely difficult predicament to find yourself in. You've agreed to take on additional responsibilities that you hadn't originally signed on for. You were hired to be a teacher, and now they're asking you to be an administrator. And I happen to have that skill set. I happen to have worked in the business world. I worked for a software company before I had come to Adams State. I'd been the education director. I had developed curriculum. I'd done a lot of different things in different contexts before I had come to Adams State. I imagine that Debbie had also had other experiences. And from my perspective, she was fantastic. She did the job adequately. So she was finding herself in June of 2007, still not knowing whether she would have a job July 1st. The provost at the time finally got back to her mid-June, 2 weeks before the end of her contract, to say that they did decide to award the they brought another candidate to campus. They had done, the on-campus interviews with her and another candidate, and they did decide to offer it to her. But because of seeing the writing on the wall and that precarity that she was put in, the precarious situation she was put in, she had done her own job search, found a better offer, a tenured position. And she was a VP, and she just stepped away from Adams State, made twice as much money, didn't have to have that sort of Damocles hanging over her head whether or not she'd be able to keep her job.
It's hilarious because as you were just telling that story, I wanted to introduce you to the Sword of Damocles as a concept that I did not know at the time I was at Adams State, but am now more familiar with. And here you are, name-checking that very same Sword of Damocles.
Yes, the mythical sword that hangs above your head, I think of above your bed, actually, and it could fall on you at any moment, yes. So Adams State found itself in the situation of shortly before July 1st, needing a director, and the other person wasn't interested. They didn't offer it to him, or he did not take the position. And so within a week, I discovered that I was going to become the interim director. So I did that from 2007. We also, Debbie had talked me into helping her host the Colorado Association for Developmental Education annual convention at Adams State. And so I was also taking on the role of hosting a state conference in a few months. And also she had been on the executive board for the co-aid. And so that left a hole that I just had to fill in her shoes and teach my classes and do the things that I had intended to do. I was in the unique position of being the interim director of the developmental education program as they were beginning a search for it. So I got to write the job description. I consulted with all of the other, I was an active member of the Colorado Association of Developmental Education, and I knew all of the developmental education directors across the state. I had been working in developmental education in the Front Range when I lived in Littleton, Colorado. I worked at Arapahoe Community College in their developmental writing program. I, still had my contacts all over the state. And I said, what do you think about this? I need to write this job description. I coupled together documents from all of these people everywhere. And at the time in 2007, none of them had a terminal degree. All of them had a master's degree. So I wrote the job description to indicate master's degree required, PhD preferred, but not required. And at the time, I had a master's degree. I had you know, relevant experience at these other organizations. And I was successfully doing the job. I had gotten positive feedback that I, you know, that my people that I worked with, my students, everything was moving smoothly. The hiring committee, however, decided to change that requirement to be PhD required. And then they notified me that you will not be a candidate for this position because you do not have your PhD. They went on to do the national search, and huge fucking surprise, there wasn't anyone willing to work at that institution for that pay and also had a PhD, so they did a failed search. Well, when you do a failed search, you have to still do the work that was being done by the person. So I am familiar with the failed search, but
the institution still needs all the services performed. And so then you're like, well, what are you going to do now? You already said that I was chopped liver, but there's a whole cohort of students coming in and gosh, someone's going to have to serve them, aren't they?
Right, right. Well, and this was mid-year, you know, as you know, a search year is more or less an 18-month proposition in terms of, figuring out what you're looking for and conducting the search and all of that process. I continued to do the work, but I continued to have the same budget line that was the Director of Developmental Education budget line. I continued to do all the same responsibilities, but I was demoted to a coordinator.
Is that the point at which you transitioned officially from faculty to staff, or when did that designation?
Yeah, I forgot about that detail. So that same summer of 2007, when I left campus in May, I turned in my final grades and, you know, was planning on having the summer off. I had faculty status. I was an instructor. At the time, the faculty handbook had bullets to indicate faculty rank, and it had, full professor, it had associate professor, assistant professor, instructor. When I came back in August, someone had edited the faculty handbook to delete the word instructor from class rank, but they left the bullet there. So there were still four bullets. And it just said,
that is such an Adam State thing to do.
Indeed.
You don't even effectively cover up all of your administrative hijinks. I'm just instantly remembering the persona non grata document that they generated to keep me off campus, but they copied and pasted the language from Fort Lewis College in Durango, and they didn't effectively change the name of the institution throughout the document. And so here's you. You're the blank bullet. Who are you? No one knows anymore because your institutional name has been deleted.
Right.
But there's a bullet. There's a placeholder for you, Karen Lemke, the omitted position.
Right, right. So already strange things were afoot in 2007, right? This is the same year that the interim director is leaving and I'm appointed. It's the same year that I'm learning, instructors are not faculty, but what does that mean? Do we still have 9-month contracts? Do we still have, and it was, you know, the slippery slope towards adjunctification, deprofessionalization,
yeah,
delegitimization of the expertise of the faculty.
Inevitably, you're adjusting your expectations as you go. You're thinking, it's not unrealistic to expect these things to change. It's like, am I out of line for thinking these things? I guess maybe I just need to recalibrate my relationship with the institution, right? You're trying to be flexible. You're trying to get along with everyone. So you're internalizing this administrative chaos or this exploitation model, and to a certain degree, you're kind of going along with it.
Right, right. And thinking, I think part of it, and I'm thinking of like Naomi Klein and disaster capitalism, but the ways that the neoliberal university, and I maybe we need to spend a little bit of time of defining what that means, but the idea that, you know, the businessification of universities means that we need to start thinking in terms of efficiency mindsets, and we need to you know, talk about
it's the shock doctrine, right? It's idea that there's always a crisis, and so everyone has to adapt to it, and there's no time for any institutional introspection or actually, you know, addressing issues of equity or anything like that.
Or shared governance or democratic principles, or even following the letter of our principles in, as spelled out in a mission statement, value statement, vision, you know, the strategic plan. These documents that are aspirational documents of what we intend to be are really more a branding exercise to help us discover who we are. And yes, to thank you for helping me remember where I was. The shock doctrine of, you know, what can we get done during this crisis? At the time, I wasn't aware. I mean, Hurricane Katrina hadn't even happened yet in terms of, you know, us understanding the way an educational system could be completely reworked you know, privatized in that case due to the requirements presented in a catastrophe. And I thought, oh well, 2007, this is a catastrophe year. This is just us adjusting to this. Not, you know, 10 years later, realizing, no, every year is a catastrophe year.
Yeah.
Every year we're going to worry about the enrollment. Every year we're going to worry about, you know, less and less faculty control of the curriculum, of the mission of the institution.
More sacrifices must be made.
Sacrifices must be made, and they must be made by you. And not these other folks. That we're not going to talk about the other folks who aren't going to make these sacrifices. We're going to focus on you making the sacrifices. So,
do we want to just hop onto what neoliberal higher education is, so that we can get that out of the way?
Yeah, and neoliberalism is you know, is a concept that people have been using, that the term relating it to sort of deregulations, efficiency mindsets, you know, focusing on deregulation of labor protections, externalization of costs. And we see that in terms of like tuition for college for many years was seen as a public good. And it was seen as something that the state, whether it was the state of Colorado or the federal government, was going to invest in this renewable resource of human beings who know something about the way the world works and have civic awareness and that sort of thing. It used to be considered something to invest in. At some point, baby boomers decided we're just going to have single-use schools and everything's just going to be disposable and you don't have to.
It's a private individual investment. It's you leveraging the individual cost of you going to school against the returns that you will make in the marketplace as a result of the value of that degree. And that is, you know, open and shut, the proposition of higher education. That's it.
Yes, yes. And you know, sometimes thinking of it as the businessification of higher ed, that can be helpful. But yeah, you put it well, that the externalization of the costs is also about focusing on people as individuals rather than the collective. And if you, Danny, individually are going to benefit from going to law school and you're going to make, you know, zillions of dollars or whatever, then you get to carry all of the risk. You know, you get to, perhaps in your circumstance, you aren't taking out student loans, but, you know, many, many people must take out student loans in order to fund their higher education. In my circumstance, I sold my house so I could use the equity from that I had in my house to pay my tuition. I did have an assistantship and that definitely helped out, but I was paying out of state tuition for my, my entire doctoral and ed specialist degrees. And in the neoliberal university, that's expected. It, you know, it's something that, it, which is absurd, you know, to think that.
And if the degree that you're pursuing doesn't have a significant return on investment, then that entire degree and that school of thinking is suspect, and it may as well be eliminated because it doesn't have direct economic value in, you know, the most the sense of an exchange of those units in the most transactional sense.
Yes, yes. And you know, transactional is another part of it. Framing people as consumers rather than thinking of people as citizens or having other roles or producers or co-collaborators or you know, relevant stakeholders. Commodification is another part of it. You know, everything is fungible. Everything is exchangeable. You can take, you know, this idea, this piece, this person, take their cog in the wheel, you can exchange it with a different thing, and it's just as equal because it's a commodity product, in the same way the commodification of our food system has broken down the relationships between producers and consumers.
So you could rank every faculty member or every department based on, you know, the input costs and the output costs. And if your department isn't the most profitable or the profitability could be increased, then that is an inefficiency that the neoliberal educational model would seek to correct. Never mind whatever other values that aren't captured in that calculation, right, would be determined. If it doesn't fit in that model, that design system is the only set of factors that we're going to control for, that we're going to adjust for, that we're going to prioritize when sacrifices have to be made to Karen's department or somewhere else.
Right, right. And
so before, yeah, and I think we kind of have that kernel. Can we transition now into what your next step was like, say, between 2009, 2012 or so?
Yes.
But I just said an arbitrary set of dates. Maybe you can put some specifics to what actually happened to transition you into the pitchforks that may not have appeared, but in fact,
well, it's a long buildup. It's a long buildup. This is Bolero, man. You know, we're just and it just started as a distant little drumbeat, a heartbeat, even, that's like, oh, okay, well, maybe this year of 2007 is a year of crisis, and it won't always be this way.
It's not kind of like, adorable how naive you are at the time, right?
Right, you look, you know, back on my,
like,
fault,
oh,
too.
Little Karen,
right.
She just thought if she got along, you know, went along to get along, that things would improve.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. Right. And I think that it's part of the structure of exploitation, is, and especially, you know, people go into teaching because of more than certainly more than the money, right? You know, I mean, there's, and I've thought about it a lot. You know, there is a huge ego boost from being a teacher, from being a professor, from being, you know, recognized as having expertise, and that's definitely part of what people are exchanging when they agree to be a teacher, an instructor, and a professor at a university like Adams State, really, but any institution.
Some social capital, some standing, some status that comes with, you know, being a professor.
Right, right. And I think that people, that is one of the pressure points or ways of coercion to get people to put up with a lot more than what they really ought to put up with. Because, you know, you don't want to lose, and especially in the Valley, right? You know, a job at Adams State is a really good job. You know, even if you're only making $40,000 a year, which again is really good money in the Valley, the idea of losing that is not only about, you know, losing your ability to pay a mortgage, losing your ability to, you know, put food on the table and whatnot, but a huge loss of status. And
well, and that's part of it, though. All of that prestige and that standing that might come with teaching at higher education isn't actually very fungible when you have to make your mortgage payments or you're standing in line to get groceries. Those things aren't translated very well. So you have to find some other reasons that actually still pay for, like, a living wage and all of the things that come with, you know, teaching. I'm just thinking about all the adjuncts who love to teach and just cannot make it. The math does not add up.
Right, right. And just before this conversation with you, Danny, I was listening to another recording you'd done with Dr. Ben Waddell about, and he was talking about the bifurcation between going down the research path in higher ed or the teaching path, and how he was at one point in his life, he was deciding, is this what I want to do? Is that what I want to do? And I think I'm bringing it up here because another thing that happens is when we do the 2020 hindsight of like, oh, I had the choice to do those two things and I chose the teaching route. Sometimes those choices are the only thing presented to you, you know, it's a non-choice choice because some other structure made the other opportunity impossible. And so you have to kind of sort of in the as we started this conversation earlier, that reluctance to examine oneself, the reluctance to do the self-criticism necessary to say, maybe even just a psychological preservation to say, I'm in charge of my life. I didn't get pushed out of my job. I chose to leave that job. I chose to take this path. I chose to, you know, those are ways that we edit our life stories to help us feel good about where we are now, instead of being like, gosh, I was really fucked. I just didn't get the thing that I wanted, and I'm still angry about it.
Yeah, you want a sense of authorship. You want some locus of control over your decisions and the story you tell about who you are. And if you feel like you're capitulating to all of these external forces, then what control do you really have over your life? And yet at the same time, when you think, these were the institutional structures I was up against, what did I expect would happen? Like, this is literally, you know, everyone else who fought those same dragons ended up getting eaten alive. Why did I think when it was my turn that it would be any different?
Right. So I found myself in 2007 and then later in 2008, really in a structural precarity that I couldn't control. And I was already... I had already had sunk costs, right? I had already, I was living in the Valley. I moved to the San Luis Valley from the Denver area, and, gave up all of the relationships, connections, whatever. I ended up going through a divorce in that time because of the stress that was, because of a lot of different reasons. That could be a whole different podcast, but losing a lot of my social structures, and Adam State really became sort of my tether to reality. I was very afraid of losing work, losing the ability to pay my bills. And I knew that I basically had to do anything to keep this particular job. And it was a job that was structurally eliminated. There was no longer a developmental education director, but the budget line was still there. They were just going to call me a coordinator. And then I had some latitude to just do whatever I wanted, as long as it would be helping enrollment management, which is even itself an interesting neoliberal construction of what an institution is doing and why a person with my skill set, who is about helping students bridge their skill gap, why am I sitting on this committee with the director of marketing and admissions folks and all the different people that at that time reported to enrollment management, which again was reconfigured in 2015, and I'm not quite sure what eventually that has become.
I wanted to jump in just quickly so our listening audience can close their eyes, listen to our voices, and visualize Karen Lemke. Above her hangs the Sword of Damocles, and below her are all of the sunk costs that are fixing to kind of subsume her if she doesn't, you know, keep running in place as fast as she can. The sunk cost fallacy, of course, is that once you've started to put resources, time, energy, money into, even if it's a losing proposition, the fact that you're invested in it gives you a sense of commitment to continue investing, even after you already recognize that it probably is a bad bet. And so I'm just imagining there's this swamp below you representing all of your sunk costs, and this Sword of Damocles hanging above you, motivating you to scurry about as quickly as possible and to be agreeable at all times, or else you'll either be subsumed by those sunk costs beneath you or beheaded by this Sword of Damocles above you.
Oh, you know, I could be impaled by the Sword of Damocles into the cesspool below. That's a third option, Danny. You know, gotta trouble the binaries.
At least you can pull yourself up by your bootstraps because this is America.
Amen, Horatio Alger. Yes, that's the way it works. 2008 started kind of a manic episode that lasted for the better part of a decade, where I created the STAY program. That was something that existed from 2008 until 2014. And what that program was my own invention of, really, it was a model that I took from my undergraduate education in a classical liberal arts great books course that we had called Freshman Studies at Lawrence University. And I took the principles of a convocation and sections that were taught by professors that came together and had a guest lecturer to speak on this great books. And because the place where I went also had a music conservatory and a lot of different performing arts sorts of orientations, our great works included works of music and sculpture and different kinds of representations to give us something to talk about and critique and develop our writing skills. So I took that great idea and created a program that basically the majority of incoming first-year students at Adams State were enrolled in. And it involved developing a course called AAA 101, Academic Achievement Strategies, which was a very MacGyvered course. There were several problems that needed to be solved in that year, including, a mandate from the NCAA that we had certain kinds of coursework available only to athletes, but I could make it universalized enough to be available to non-athletes. We had a need for like a study skills course. And I wanted to, in terms of pedagogy and developing a sheltered instruction model, I wanted to create a fall term for my incoming students who needed developmental reading, developmental writing, and developmental math, instead of sticking that kid, that young person, whatever age person, into, say, a history 101 class without adequate writing skills. At the time, we didn't have a co-learning model. I proposed doing a sheltered instruction model, meaning I'm going to keep these particular students in a complete program that gives them a lot of social programming as well. We ran a mentoring program. Erica Holmes Trujillo put together that mentoring program with me, and she actually wrote her master's thesis about the STAY mentoring program. So I created that program. I got a lot of recognition for it. I gave a presentation that year at the ACT State Conference on the STAY program. I gave a presentation the following year at an international conference on education, innovations in higher education, that was held in Spain. And that was really cool. And I got a publication out of that. And, I seem to be doing all the right things to try to address the student needs. And also, I tied in at the time, I pulled in an AmeriCorps grant, which was not an easy task, and it ended up bringing in $250,000 worth of scholarship money to the students in the nursing program and teacher education program, and a bunch of different students who qualified for this education award through the AmeriCorps Service Learning Program. I worked with the not only the faculty development committee, if you will, people like Leslie Alvarez, who were doing faculty development workshops, but I integrated service learning into curriculum across campus. There were, I think, 19 different departments at the time who were offering some level of service learning and this kind of scholarship tied to coursework and working in the community. That's part of my little manic episode that happened.
So let me just stop you there for a second. Just based on what you've described, it sounds like you are your work is a resounding success and you're being handsomely paid for it because you're doing so many tremendous things for the institution.
Danny, I taught adjunct courses for free because I wanted to make them happen. And then because of things that you posted on Watching Adams, I realized that my administrator who signed off on me doing a $0 contract for teaching those courses was paying himself for administering the English placement exam and, you know, doing things that were very much the work that I was doing. And he didn't seem to have any problem with paying himself or to, you know, I mean, he had no problem with telling me, well, you know, I can't run that course unless there are 10 students. There's only 3 students enrolled, Karen. Fine, I'll teach it. I'll teach it. I won't ask another instructor to do that, but I'll do it.
And you're doing it because there's some other sense of investment or there's some other set of rewards that you're pursuing or that you're even receiving other than the monetary compensation. And that bit is, I think, difficult to understand for people that have a transactional relationship with their work, with their career, with their, you know, areas of their life. But for people who love what they do and, more importantly, believe in the mission that they can actually make the world a better place by virtue of the work they do, you were probably driven in part by those ideals, I would imagine, in addition to all of the sunk costs and sort of Damocles we discussed earlier. Did it feel fulfilling at the time to do what you were doing? All else being equal, was it sustainable?
It was not sustainable. And I suffered health problems. I had a lot of stress during those, especially in 2008 and 2009. And I want to talk a little bit about the Title V grant competition in 2009, because my it felt like more and more I was taking bigger and bigger personal risks, like, you know, writing my salary into a grant line item rather than coming from institutional dollars, meaning this is life or death. You know, if we don't get this Title V grant, Karen's not going to have a salary. And we didn't get that Title V grant. But in terms of, is it fulfilling to me? One thing that this also produced, this neoliberal university and the precarity produced, was a sense of autonomy. I mean, I really was able to do very creative, innovative, creative problem solving ideas. I had at the time Mike Mumper was my boss, and he encouraged me in many ways to, like, you know, see what this does to, you know, do some research on that, come back and tell me, give me a proposal, you know, I'll try to find you money. And to be fair, he made a lot of things happen because, it's like two sides of the same coin. I was so terrified of losing my job that I was in this hyper adrenaline mode of, like, producing and creating and seeking, and, you know, especially seeking grant dollars, getting better at doing something that is so onerous, you know, filling out paperwork for grants, managing faculty who can't turn in the paperwork needed for the grant, you know, all of the interpersonal and soft skills that I had to use and deploy to administer things that I'd never set out to administer. In some ways, I could see myself as a victim, you know, I put myself in a victim position, but it also gave me, I have a really weird looking resume, Danny. You know, it's unbelievable that a person could spend a decade or, you know, 9 years working at an institution and do so many different weird little things.
I sort of imagine that you have the resume of the functional equivalent of a pinball inside a pinball machine, and all of the different, you know, bumpers and flippers and lights and gears and everything that you ran into and had to adapt in order to keep moving inside this frenetic system. And so, you know, in any given moment, it probably did make sense to react in the reactive way that you were to get through that next set of problems, to continue with the work you were doing to plug all of the holes. I think about, you know, all of the holes in the boat or the sinking ship. And so you're there MacGyvering your way through all of these problems. But then if you were to step back and say, wow, why is this person, you know, running around so much institutionally, vocationally, in terms of their skill set, to be able to address these things? And you then have to have the talk to explain, here's what happened when I was in this, effectively this, you know, this war zone or this fog of war, or the shock doctrine of not necessarily being clear in the moment about what the bigger institutional goal is, because you're reacting so much to that moment-to-moment adrenaline-fueled process.
And I also, in the same way that my predecessor, in terms of being the interim director of the Developmental Education Program, seeing the writing on the wall that this can't last. You know, I've got a master's degree and I don't have, at the time, online learning was developing. I mean, I looked at a lot of different doctoral programs. I looked at, you know, different models that I would have been able to do online or, working in the summertime or you know, some way. And I don't know if I mentioned this, but my contract went from being a 9-month contract to a 12-month contract without me in that first summer, where I was like, well, wait, what happened here? You know, I used to be faculty.
One could look at that as job security. Oh, now I'm sort of full time instead of 9 months. But what that actually means is you just took effectively a 25% pay cut, right? Unless you were given the salary increase commensurate with a 12-month contract.
So I have to think a little bit. I think I was hired at $32,000 for a 9-month contract as an instructor in 2006. And oh, by the way, those numbers did not really go up at all. I mean, again, listening to Ben talk about, you know, tenure track lines coming in at like 42,000 is that was that way when I started, and I think it was, you know, probably not that much higher than that when I left in 2015. When I transitioned from being a 9-month contract instructor to taking on the interim position, what I did is I it wasn't a raise, but I was I can almost think of the the budget code, 028 budget code was the developmental ed budget code. And the English instructor line was the 32,000, and the director of developmental ed was like a 40,000. So I started getting paid at the $40,000 code. I was still teaching the developmental writing courses because I had not yet hired Kathy Heaton was the person I ended up hiring, Kathleen Chavez, and many, many, many wonderful, great, great instructors over the years that we were able to hire. And you know, I know that students had really good experiences with those instructors. Anyway, so I didn't quite get a raise. I mean, I have an $8,000 difference in what happened, and the expectation that even though you were planning on taking the summer off, Karen, we need you to come in and start building what's going to happen for fall semester, because the person, you know, we don't have an interim director of developmental education, and we don't really have we need you to do this work.
Yeah, but guess what? That means you have 3 more months to prove your worth and really show how great you are, to get your foot in the door and really secure that that institutional legacy and career advancement that you want, right?
Right, yeah. Just continually keep auditioning for the position that you hope to get, because maybe someday we're going to give that to you. I should also mention, when I interviewed as an instructor, the English department chair at the time suggested that instructor role would not turn into an empty bullet in the faculty handbook, but would in fact turn into a tenure track position.
Sounds familiar.
What a nice thing to say to someone on an on-campus interview, like, oh, I would certainly like to have the protections of tenure, and you know, that would be fantastic. Thanks for mentioning that. Yeah, and as you know, as many people know, that was never the case. I don't know. Well, I can't say never. I don't know that didn't happen for some faculty positions, but certainly in my circumstance and in other people that have been promised some sort of like, oh, we're going to, you know, upgrade your position. Well, what motive would they have to do that after you've already signed the contract? You know, if you've already agreed.
And And I think as most people are aware, the kind of institutional trend between, say, 1970 and today is that adjuncts have gone from being very rare and tenured faculty being, you know, the broad majority of those teaching on campus to the opposite, that most classes now are taught by adjuncts and tenure track or tenured faculty are the minority of in most higher ed institutions.
Right. Deprofessionalization, adjunctification, and maybe it's even accelerated. I haven't been following through these COVID semesters here as closely, but I'm guessing that
things are pretty dire in higher ed from the outside looking in. Reports, research. You know, I probably read the same trades as everyone else, but it's not looking good right now. And COVID has done to many sectors of our economy and many areas of our society, exposed a lot of the, you know, structural deficiencies that were already there and forced us to acknowledge not only how real they are, but how pervasive and how they are bad getting worse. And a $600 payment is not going to solve them.
Yeah.
At some point, I remember we went to a conference together. It was like the annual retreat, and I caught a piece of a conversation you were having with several other colleagues about the disadvantages of having positions that were grant funded, and the notion that, like, well, you know, if the grant isn't renewed or there's some other issue, then the position might disappear, but the need that position was created to fill is still very much there. And what do we do about that?
And, you know, tying back to what we were talking about with the neoliberalization of higher education, that is an externalization of costs. You know, if you can get Title V, which is a multi-year, you know, five-year, $6 million, $5 million grant that is for capacity building and, you know, is meant to help a specific type of institution, in this case, a Hispanic-serving institution, meaning an institution that has 25% or more enrollment of people of Hispanic heritage, self-identified. It is a way of marginalizing those resources as not being central to the institutional mission. And I think that's sort of a difficult thing to reckon about. It's fantastic that there is a Title V program that, and other grant. I mean, there were many other grants that I was involved with, federal grants, including like the AmeriCorps grant. We had some private money, foundation money that we had gotten, the infamous Walmart grant, the EPIC program. Institutional money, dollars that are earmarked specifically that come from either state dollars, the tuition revenue, the institution, that basket of money is separate from baskets of money that are kind of catch-as-catch-can in terms of the Title V competition to win that grant that we were just describing and other grant opportunities. And, you know, some in the grant community world talk about it being a kind of industrial grant complex in terms of what we're really doing is we're forcing these institutions to compete against each other to get a higher and higher score. You need to get a 97 or higher to qualify, you know, out of 100 points, 98 or higher, so that you're again rewarding, you know, success to the successful is a gamification structure that can kind of break a game. And that's exactly what you're doing when you're rewarding monies to institutions that can pass the competition, that can be successful under these neoliberal constraints. You know, it's complicated because, I mean, there are definitely many, many fantastic things that have come from the Title V competition grants that I had been involved with. It's something that happens every 5 years. So that was just two of those grant writing and administrating seasons that I was involved in. As I was just trying to say, when you sort of segregate out institutional dollars and grant dollars, you're also kind of saying these grant dollars are expendable or not essential to the core mission of the institution. And I mean, some of the grants, one of the innovative grants we did required the VP of finance, Bill Manchine at the time, to sign off that after that, this was a phased 3 years, that the first year of the grant would pay 100%. The second year of the grant, it would be 50% coming from the grant and 50% coming from institutional dollars. And by year three, we would be transitioning to like 75-25, so that by year four, the institution would fully be carrying on the continuity of what this, you know, what we had used this grant to develop to make that a permanent aspect of the institution. That didn't end up happening either, but I think at the time it was innovative. At the time, I was like, yeah, every grant should do that. You know, making sure that if you really care about this, if you really, you know, if these grant dollars are meant to do something that's not just a Band-Aid, but to do real institutional change, we're going to write into your accepting of these grant dollars a commitment that you're going to do that very thing. So 2015 was the last year that I worked at Adams State. I'm going to back up just a little bit to 2012, though, because in that Sword of Damocles situation that we've been describing, I did make a commitment that I wanted to pursue a doctorate. I figured I'm working in higher ed. I have to finish this. I don't know how I'm going to do it, but I'm going to do it. So I started researching, looking at different programs, applying to different programs, being a developmental educator, being at that time a board member of the Colorado Association of Developmental Education, board president, in fact, and being involved with planning the national program, the National Association for Developmental Education conference in Denver that year. I got much more involved with the Center for Developmental Education, the National Center for Developmental Education, which is based at Appalachian State University in North Carolina, in Boone, North Carolina. And so in 2012, I applied for a competition. I applied for a scholarship that I won to go to a four-week intensive to begin the process of getting a certification in developmental education. But the courses would, if I was willing to pay university tuition, I could count those towards an EDS degree. An EDS is a specialist in education degree. It's a postmaster's degree, 30 credit hours after a master's degree. I have a master's degree in English and rhetoric and composition. Computer-mediated communication. That was what I did a long time ago. And
well, I don't know what happened to that, but maybe there's been some developments in that field, huh?
No kidding. I wrote my master's thesis on the World Wide Web.
I can hear the sound of the dial-up modem right now.
Yes.
Maybe I'll add it into the podcast so everyone else can hear it as well.
We talked about hypertext markup language, and my master's thesis was about a hyperlink, which is an underlined word in text, how that is related to relative pronouns. I did a bunch of like analysis of student writing before and after navigating the internet and using these web links that took you to more and additional information in the same way that a relative clause gives you more and additional information in a sentence. And my hypothesis was that students would use more of these relative clauses after navigating the internet for 20 minutes or whatever I had set up as my experimental condition in my very quantitative research project that I did for my master's.
Well, our listeners can't see this, but Karen was using the air quotes for navigating the internet. So just imagine.
So I started.
So you wanted to pursue that degree, you're saying, while you were still at Adams State. And the thinking was that by doing so, you might be able to parlay into more of what you were seeking to get that failed search, right, that you wanted to...
Right, because I was stuck. I was just stuck. Yeah. And I remember having conversations with Dr. Mumper at the time, like, you know, what is possible for me here? You know, how do I get out of this purgatory? And You know, and I said, you know, I've been looking at doctoral programs, and he encouraged me. He's like, you know, I don't know what that, where that's going to lead. I don't know if, you know, we'll create a position here for you or what will happen. But, you know, if you're willing to do it, I support you. You know, I will make sure that you get the time or which really is, it is generous for an employer to be like, I'm going to support you on doing this thing that might actually lead you to leaving the institution. You
know? It's almost like higher education should promote, encourage, and help to facilitate ongoing education for the people that are there, right? Instead of tossing them out and getting new people all the time. It's like, well, these are the resources. We have all the tools, you know, from one end of the institution to the other. And if not, can't we build them within to be able to do that, right? That was the thinking.
Right.
And that's,
grow your
that's
own.
The aspiration.
Grow your yeah. own. And you know, and I definitely, I mean, it's breathtaking how many people, how many Hispanic men and women in the San Luis Valley have terminal degrees, have PhDs, who have no affiliation with the university, because who cares, right? Why would we want to hire our own? Why would we want to grow our own? I mean, there are a handful of really great examples of local folks. I mean, yourself included, I suppose, people who were born in the Valley who ended up working at Adams State University in tenure track lines. There's so many more who aren't than who are, you know, and again, when we focus on the positive stories of the people who remain rather than the stories of the people who have departed, either of their own volition or getting run out of town, so to speak, then you lose that part of the story. So again, in 2012, I was having conversations with my boss, like, what do I need to do here? You know, what can I do to get a pay increase too? Because I'm just always going to make $40,000. I can, and I mean, to be fair, I did get some additional compensation for running the AmeriCorps program. I happened to find that piece of paper when I was cleaning out things during COVID cleanout in March and April, and it was about $1,400. You know, like I got little yeah. additional contracts, so I did end up making more than $40,000. Set, you know, several of the semesters there, but basically, I as you talked about before on this podcast, the only real way you could get more money is if you do more work. And then I was like, well, what if I get a doctorate? What if I get a terminal degree? Well, then we could talk about a pay increase for you, Karen. And I was like, all right, you know, I'm going to hang my hopes on this. I'm going to apply all of this, you know, frenetic, this manic energy towards a pathway, either a pathway to stay here or a pathway out.
We've talked about adjunctification before, but in addition to that, something at Adams State that we've documented on Watching Adams and you just alluded to is the way there's a kind of a microcosm of a gig economy within an institution. So if you want to make more, we're not going to actually pay you what might be comparable at other institutions, our peer institutions, etc. But here are all these other side hustles that you can do while you're at Adams State to help actually, you know, compensate you to the equivalent of what you thought you might make or what you were projected to make if you were at another institution. That is in part how Adams State was put on academic probation by the Higher Learning Commission, because they were encouraging faculty to run so many side hustles with online education that they, you know, they almost inevitably ended up compromising the quality of education. So you're either making huge sacrifices in the rest of your life, and you alluded to your divorce earlier, you know, or inevitably you have to cut some corners somewhere to be able to do more work in the same amount of time. How is that going to happen? So in addition to the adjunctification component, there's like this gig economy where everyone is doing all these side hustles just to make ends meet. As some people leave, you know, you assume more of their responsibilities as well. So there's just a whole lot of lateral moves that people do just in order to stay afloat. That isn't necessarily part of their core mission. And some of what you described with the AmeriCorps funding, et cetera, it sounds like was at least in part in the service of trying to make what you thought you would be making.
Yes, yes. And I think the side hustle is a good frame for it, because it does feel very contingent, temporary. In this particular circumstance at Adam State, if you were a full-time employee with benefits, and I don't know how much emphasis we can put on how important it is to have continuity of healthcare. Before COVID, but you know, if you have any kind of medical concerns, you're getting on in years in any respect, your commitment, your willingness to do just about anything to maintain access to a healthcare plan really eclipses a lot of other professional goals you might have. And it's a very slippery slope in the sense of like, well, if I'm compensated $40,000 to do this one job, well, sure, I could take on one more class. Sure, I could coordinate this one more project. I could do this. I could do that. And because and I'm not as familiar with what the Higher Learning Commission had with its findings and its criticisms of what Adam State had done, I can make some guesses that it involved basically an exploitative kind of situation where people were possibly making more money from their,
A few people were teaching a huge number of students that one could not possibly deliver quality education to in the context in which it was presented because they were getting paid per student.
Yeah.
And so if each student, that's the neoliberal model right there, these are customers. And if you want to increase, you know, sales or revenue, then you increase the volume of sales. And so you get more people through the door, through the virtual door in this case. And that's how you deliver the product of education, in high volume. You know, it's like someone on Watching Adams posted recently about how Adam State has almost modeled itself to some degree as the Walmart of higher education. And the Walmart model is, you know, deliver a lot of really cheap product to the most people you possibly could. Quality is a secondhand concern. And for many people that believe in what they do, I think, Karen, as you've described, you wouldn't think of it that way. But the institutional structure almost forces your hand to make some of those decisions, whether you wanted to or not. So at this point, do you want to talk about renewed effort to get a degree so that you could get the position that you were pursuing since 2006, 2007?
Correct.
And here it is 2012, and you're of the hope that it would lead to that?
Yes,
but
yes.
By 2015, it turns out it would not.
Right. So and along the way, so in 2012, I started taking this summer intensive program that ended up leading me into this postmaster specialist in education degree, which many consider to be a terminal degree as a specialist in education. I completed that in 2014. In fact, Annie, you helped me write my final project. We did we co-taught a course called Becoming College Material or something like that. It was a digital storytelling course that we did with students at Centauri High School, and it was super awesome. I completed the EDS in 2014, and then I was told there were no funds for a raise at that time. So I probably should have again seen the writing on the wall and thought, well,
I imagine sort of Charlie Brown going to kick the football, right, and always just failing to do so, even though it was quite foreseeable that might be the outcome. But Karen gave it one more college try, so to speak.
The college try, exactly.
The old college try.
And you know, to talk about a different little branch of the things that happened in my life in that time, in 2014, 2013, as Danny knows well, there was a lawsuit that I was involved with. What is now the Rio Grande Farm Park had sort of a rocky start that involved a group of us, myself included, becoming plaintiffs in a law school against Alamosa School District about the purchase of that 35-acre parcel that became the Rio Grande Farm Park.
38 acres along the Rio Grande River, once Polston Elementary School, where I attended, then became the Healthy Living Park and now the Rio Grande Farm Park after it was almost turned into a luxury RV resort by a local land surveyor that believed it would be a great place for people to park their RVs and recreate during the summer months.
Yeah, there's...
Never mind all of the alluvial soil that had been used for generations for agricultural purposes, or the fact that it was, you know, a river walk that the community enjoyed as a public asset. So, different story for a different time, but you were involved in the community in a pretty elevated way for the purpose of public advocacy and looking out for, you know, some of the institutional designs that were being exploited and the people that weren't getting opportunities to grow food, to participate in kind of the microeconomy that one could. I remember many conversations we had about that time.
Right.
But it sounds like this is one of the questions that I have highlighted. What do white Christian supremacy, ag policy, and higher education have in common? This might be a time to tie that all in together in the 2013-2014 timeframe. I don't know what you meant when you wrote that, but I want to find out.
Okay, I'm glad you have that highlighted story. Okay, well, I'm going to put a pin in the intersection between Adams State University and the Rio Grande Farm Park lawsuit to answer this question, since I did give you a list of podcast ideas, and that was one that you were excited about. White Christian supremacy, agriculture policy, and higher education. Those are three, you know, pretty prior to even a year ago, I hadn't really looked at the intersections among those three structures. I guess I'll talk a little bit about where I am and the kinds of research and things that I'm doing right now. I'm very thoughtful about naming the structures that perpetrate a hurt. You know, a lot of times we talk about deficiencies. We talk in a deficit language about, you know, farm workers, or we talk about, you know, people on the lower end of a binary being victims of something, and we focus on their victimhood rather than who is perpetrating.
Who is creating all those victims?
That are creating these victims. What would happen if we didn't have, you know, how can we go upstream to see where the bodies are coming from rather than just pulling the bodies out of the river? Exactly. So that's sort of where I've been positioning myself since I wrote my dissertation, because, you know, when you go to grad school and you are writing all the time, you're researching all the time, your brain turns into a certain consistency that either you keep doing that, or you smoke a lot of marijuana, or you do something to like deal with your life after you finish graduate school. And I figured, instead of just smoking a lot of marijuana, I'm going to also use these analytic skills to think about what are the other structures that are creating privileges. A big thing I'm landing on is structures of inherited privilege, and white Christian supremacy, which is also a very male-centric worldview, is very much about closing communities, closing out opportunities to talk with people who are different from you, creating the idea of in-group being superior to out-group, and in terms of like agricultural societies and founding, because historically we have had agricultural policies like the homesteading acts, those specific legal and political structures were designed to exclude non-white people and men and non-male people. And so you, in terms of ag policy a century ago, we created the conditions for rural areas to exist in terms of a white settler colonial way of looking at what we call rural areas. And of course, Adams State being situated in the center of a very, very rural area in the United States, one of the most rural areas in the United States. A lot of people, a lot of white identifying people who own land have benefited from these historical legacy of an ancestor, a so-called pioneer, who, you know, came across the plains and either got some land given to them because they were willing to, uproot from wherever they had been to move to the San Luis Valley or wherever they had moved to, and that was only available to white men. there's a quite a bit of legacy of that that is continuing into present ag policy. In the same way that we began this conversation about, like, you know, there's the stories of the winners and the stories of the people who stepped off of the treadmill and are no longer in that institution. Black farmers, for instance, used to own something like 4% of U.S. farmland, and now it's, a very tiny percentage of 1% of U.S. farmland, a lot of it due to heirs property and different, struggles with determining who owns a property after someone's died. If you don't have proper documentation registered in a deed in a courthouse somewhere, in a county clerk office, and some of it is literally violence against Black people. It was people burning down a Black person's barn, lighting a cross in front of their home, creating lynching, murdering people with impunity. Burning down part of Tulsa to really force the supremacy of who gets to decide what wealth looks like in our community. So in terms of connecting these ideas of supremacy and in-group behavior and intolerance for hearing from other perspectives that challenge that sense of authority, that sense of legitimacy. The only legitimate farmers in that worldview are white male landowning farmers, multi-generational farming practices. I wrote about this in the dissertation as well, that when Adam State in particular was looking at putting together a food studies program, they interviewed people who owned farms, people who owned restaurants, people who were of this ownership class. Yes, there were some Hispanic people that they definitely interviewed, but when you're looking at building a new educational program and you only interview certain voices to figure out what that program is going to look like, you may end up reproducing the structures that create the outcomes that we see, the racialized outcomes, the gendered outcomes, the social class outcomes versus people who own things and people who work for people who own things.
And very likely, if those are the structures you're most familiar with that you know, you wouldn't necessarily even know that's a problem. You might not even stop to recognize a deficiency because, again, going back to what we talked about earlier, the stories we tell ourselves about the way things work. And then there's no need to look outside of that because there's either not an awareness of or there's not a recognition toward the importance of those other possibilities or those underserved populations.
Danny, I just want to pull in something that's been on my mind this week about people pretending they don't recognize bad behavior.
Yeah.
In terms, exactly as you've just described, this, this sensation of the system is working. I don't, from my perspective, my privileged perspective, and I may not even recognize, there are many ways in which we are simultaneously privileged and underprivileged at the same time. I'm definitely receiving many privileges of having light skin, of being read as passing as a white person. And I'm also, present as a person assigned female at birth and experiencing the downsides of being on a binary as well. Coming back to that idea of not recognizing bad behavior because it doesn't impact you. As I'm trying to look forward to what can Karen Lemke do with this big, juicy brain of mine, with my five mm-hmm. college degrees, how am I going to help build the beloved community? As Martin Luther King said, the work towards the reconciliation of recognizing all of our brothers and sisters and siblings, that, that we are connected, that I can't just say, well, I'm not a Black person, so I don't really care that police agents are killing children because they're playing, the injustices of a criminal justice system that doesn't really seem to not be working because I'm navigating in a space where it doesn't impact me. And so I've been really meditating on that, the idea of looking at the white Christian supremacy and the relationships that I have in my own family, in my immediate kin, blood kin family, that I should be confronting and talking about. You know, how can I help my mother? How can I help my uncles, my people in my life who could possibly be influenced by me to expand their worldview beyond, you know, a white neighborhood that they've only thing they've ever known, you know, a worldview, a Christian, you know, a church community that means very, very much to them. And hearing from me how this is part of a structure that is broken in the United States, in the world.
So if I'm going to hop back in, you were involved in a lawsuit. It was successfully mediated to ensure that the property was maintained in public ownership and that it was available and accessible for anyone to be able to recreate or to be able to, you know, learn more about agriculture. So it sounds like you were branching out in the community in significant ways with the Local Foods Coalition, with beekeeping, with this public interest plaintiff work you had done, even as you were trying to, you know, angle things in a way with Adam State such that it could be sustainable, such that you would be able to stay and also to thrive. I want to know at what point you decided to actually throw in the towel or get chased out of town or, you know, whatever euphemism we'll use here, why you didn't just redouble your efforts one more time, so to speak.
I brought up the Rio Grande Farm Park because I really deliberated about becoming a plaintiff. I looked mm-hmm. around the room. I mean, I think you may have been at some of the community meetings that I was at.
The same meetings, making the same decisions.
Maybe 80 of us in a room, which is hard to imagine today in post-COVID, but, you know, in our COVID world. But
right.
There were like 80 of us. And I remember looking around the room and there were people who were like, I've got kids in the school district. I can't do this. You know, I can't lose my job. I work with, you know, I'm cousins with that person. I can't risk this. Yeah. And here I stood. I don't have kids in the school district. I do work at the university. At the time, I was president of the board of the Local Foods Coalition. And we had just put all of these negotiations in place with the Trust for Public Land and you know, all of the financial structures that were about to make that transaction possible. And so I felt quite a pull towards stepping forward to be a plaintiff, also recognizing that it might mean I'd lose my job eventually.
Sorry, I think I've touched on this elsewhere, but you just hit on something that's important to think about, which is this broader sense of hesitation to become more active in a potentially contentious community issue because of the precarity of your economic or social standing. And you and I are relatively privileged for the Adam State community at the time, in that if the worst came to worst, we probably would be able to improvise a solution for our lives that would be more easily achieved than many other people in that same room who looked around and said, you know, the stakes are just too high for me to go up against the school board or for me to put myself out in a way that could be acrimonious or something like that. But it still, if it didn't come at a direct cost in terms of your social standing or your relationship to Adam State, it definitely signified that you were less than willing to be completely agreeable and subservient to the way we do things around here, right? And the way we do things around here included Adam State, but it also included the school board. It also included the manner in which the property was sold and the sort of the old boys club that presided over many of those transactions.
Some transactions, possibly even being bribes, as has been rumored. In any case, it was certainly not a decision I took lightly. I remember talking to people like Kiko, oh my goodness, you know, that pointed out like, you know,
Francisco Martinez, a legend in his own time. Yeah.
Yes. And the idea that like a lawsuit can change you and you don't, I mean, I think you've been a plaintiff in two, Danny.
Amen to that. It's changed the trajectory of my life without question. Yeah.
And,
for sure.
And, you know, at the time, I really saw that farm park and that that precious, sacred land. I mean, I remember hearing people like Trudy Kretzinger talk, you know, poets like Trudy Kretzinger talk about the beauty of that land in ways that just, you know, even now bring a lump to my throat and tears to my eyes, because it's such a magical, beautiful, primeval piece of earth that we happen to have the privilege of being able to ride our bicycles along and grow food there, and you know, it being this, it was an anchor in my life at that time, and it made the most sense for me to throw myself into the ring, and I did check with Dr. Mumper before I participated to get his blessing, which he gave. And he saw, you know, no conflict. He didn't see any reason why I would receive retaliation for participating in that lawsuit.
Just as a side note, the president of the university at that time was the brother-in-law of one of the school board members. And among the many other kind of relationships that evolved out of that, you know, in a small town community where people find themselves on opposite sides of a lawsuit, but also a public controversy, just the sense that I was seeking a tenure track position at the same time that there was this acrimonious or adversarial relationship developing with people that had connections directly to, you know, my employer, the chief operating officer, so to speak, of the employer that I had. But at the same time, it was not a direct concern, if and until, I would say, there was a petition that was circulated in the local newspaper of people who supported the RV park development. And on that list of people was the president of the university, which I just found sort of personally heartbreaking, because I was like, we're a public higher education institution, and you're endorsing, you're standing behind the privatization of public land on which an elementary school that I attended once sat. What, you know, and we could talk about how there's a lot of like right-wing Republican-leaning interests involved in that side of the transaction, but who are no friend of higher education largely, but you know, and so when I asked him about that in an email, he basically said, I'm surprised that you're surprised. The other member of the school board is my brother-in-law. That's not a sufficient explanation for why you're, you know, leveraging your namesake as president of the university to endorse the privatization of a public asset. Like, that is woefully inconsistent. It would be better not to have responded to my email than to have replied by saying, well, my brother's on the school board. Well, are you serious?
Well, and, you know, coming back to the one highlighted question that we got to, what do white Christian supremacy and higher education have in common? An idea about loyalty, you know, loyalty to your in-group, loyalty to your family, loyalty to people who go to your church. And there are definitely structures at Adams State, but while I was at Appalachian State, the president of that, the chancellor of that university, and all of the key important people, they all attended the same church. You know, there is a structure behind the structure that when, half a decade ago when we were, you know, trying to figure out, well, how do things really happen here?
Yeah.
One of those structures behind the structure is a religious affiliation.
The athletic director, the president of the university, they attend the same church, and it's off the ledger, right? It's not on the map that we're mapping, but there's this underlying set of ideological values, metaphysical beliefs about how the universe works, and those are applied to the decision-making processes at every level of government.
Across the board, right. Instead of it being compartmentalized, there is a sense that, you know, if someone is a religious leader, and of course, these are religions in both cases that are male-centric religions. Only men have leadership positions in, you know, formalized leadership. And you know, in some of these religions, a more direct connection to the divine message or whatnot.
Who is also male. Like, all of the figures in that lineage, that divine lineage, are male, from the creator of the universe down to the officiator of the religious revelations.
Right. So, yeah. So people who attend a church where there is a deacon or bishop, or, you know, there's a structure of leadership, and you, every Sunday or Saturday or, you know, wherever you, whenever you practice your faith, you see that person as having authority and being a community leader, and overgeneralizing that to say, well, this guy would be a good athletic director, or this guy should become the department chair, you know, should go from being an adjunct to a department chair to a VP, you know, without a PhD, by the way, because he's a good leader in this other context. It's an overgeneralization because of the blinders of an in-group identification that is explicitly exclusive of people who aren't in that in-group.
I mean, I will tell you, studying law now, that often what I've recognized about human systems is that there is the kind of front that we produce that justifies the structures and systems that we have, and that becomes the pretext for whatever we want to do anyway. And so if on the front end we say, well, these are the laws, these are the bylaws, this is the faculty handbook, or whatever structure we're using to ostensibly make our decisions, but let's be honest, we're going to end up doing what we want to do anyway. There is a back end to this that is never shown to you, but that's how all the decisions are actually made. And those decisions will be made not on any bases that we can map out on paper per se, like you have the required degree or whatever, but because these systems were in place before we created the front that we're now showing to you, that give them a sense of legitimacy, ostensible neutrality. You know, that's there for you to believe you could get through if you follow all the prescribed steps, right? But when your number comes up and it's time to actually put that system to work, it will fail you. So just as you've described your situation, many people thought, well, Danny didn't get hired at Adams State because he doesn't have a terminal degree. He doesn't have a PhD, and an MFA is a terminal degree for filmmaking. Right. The person they hired instead of me also had an MFA. But at the time that was happening, this kid that grew up there that became a valued community member within Adams State, they had to tell a story about why this didn't work out. And it had to rely on that front-facing set of institutional or operational decisions. It couldn't be anything on the back end about why someone is selected out or chased out of town as a result of what happened. So that's my soapbox. Yeah. Continue.
To 2015 and chasing out of town. So I was involved in the lawsuit, and as you know, probably all the listener or many of the listeners will know, it was decided in such a way that now there is a Rio Grande Farm Park, and you know, many wonderful things are certainly happening there. But it did sort of leave. I can't prove it. I can't, you know, declare that there was a stain, that there was a taint that was associated with Karen Lemke and Karen Lemke's involvement. Because certainly, in some ways, I was heroic, right? Look at this. We had these 10 plaintiffs who were willing to step forward and make this beautiful thing possible.
And guess what? The Rio Grande Farm Park, as it sits today, has a much stronger institutional compatibility with Adams State than the RV resort ever would. So even if you just kept the narrow hat of what is good for my employer and my institution, there's no question in my mind that the path you took would benefit your institution more than the alternative.
And yet there is a sense that, you know, one way of looking at it is I signed my termination papers. You know, it was when the opportunity would come. Maybe it's not this year, maybe it'll be in 3 years, but if we're doing a reorganization and we have to eliminate some budget lines, we'll keep that in mind. And you know, and that's a
and
structure.
It will be done in a totally it will be done in a legitimate, totally
you know, defensible.
Right. What's the word I'm looking for? Like a sanitized way, like there won't be any kind of directed or specific explanation for you. It will be using the language of the businessification of higher ed. Someone with an MBA will come up with a term for it in terms of right-sizing the institution. And Karen just got right-sized out of the institution, or there's some, you know, shifting of organizational structures that just conveniently leaves that bullet point with the blank next to it off the next set of budget items or restructuring.
Yeah.
And is that what happened? I mean, what actually happened? Is there a specific day that you knew the day before wasn't the case, but now you're not coming back to Adams State after 9 years?
When they dismantled the developmental education. Well, okay. In February of 2014, I and Kathy Heaton and Kathleen Chavez, so basically the developmental writing program, developmental reading and writing program, we were looking at innovating the STAY program in such a way that we could accelerate students to take like an 8-week accelerated version of the developmental course, take the EPE midterms, and then be able to move into an English 101 course for the second 8 weeks of a fall term. By December, they could enroll into the 102 section. We wanted to accelerate the developmental sequencing, which was a best practice at the time. It was, considered to be, believe me, I did all the research. I had all the documentation. Again, I was completely embedded in the not only in the developmental ecosystem of Colorado higher education, the national level of the developmental organization, but I was a not yet a doctoral student, but I was finishing my EDS my degree is a specialist in developmental education. It's a very specific kind of specialization. So I knew a lot about what would be the right thing to do at the time, the best practice for supporting the types of learners that we had, the types of learners that Adams State had. And I went to the English department and I said, we really need to coordinate between the math department and the English department, because this sort of scheduling, I have to make sure that if their developmental math sections are offered at times that are complementary, that they are able to do these 8-week modules. And of course, I'm willing to do all of the work. I'm willing to, set up the meetings and make sure that Matt Nearing and all the right people are talking to the right people. And I will double check. I will proof the schedule to make sure that it doesn't have conflicts. I'm willing to do all of the work. I just need you to sign off on this agreement. And instead of just, recognizing me as an expert in my field, which at that point, I literally had a specialist in developmental education. I'd been running a developmental education program. I had been, very, very involved in it. In any other circumstance, people should have been able to say, brilliant idea, Karen, how can I help you? But instead, he decided it needed to go to a vote of the English department faculty. And I think you may have been in the room at the time. People who don't have a background in developmental education, people who don't have a background in the scheduling challenges of trying to coordinate with other faculty in a completely different discipline, people who really don't have any skin in the game because they don't teach developmental courses and some of them don't want to teach developmental courses. So they put the decision making in a very paternalistic structure by saying, oh, Karen, you don't have it. Terminal degree, or you don't have tenure in this department, and you're a woman, or whatever, and I'm not going to let you have the ability to do this. I'm going to push it to another level of decision making that effectively killed the entire program. And we spent months working with the then director of the Writing Center, Writing Studio, to craft a proposal that he understood, because he had to be the one to present it to the rest of the English department faculty, because people weren't willing to listen to Kathy Heaton or Karen Lemke or Kathleen Chavez in ways that they were willing to listen to this white man who has a PhD, no expertise in developmental education, no expertise in the administrative challenges of making this coordinated coordination happen. So at that meeting in February of 2014, he, instead of presenting our carefully researched, and I mean, we spent hours trying to explain to him why it needed to be this way, why it needed to coordinate with another department, because you can't just have a standalone schedule that doesn't coordinate with this other, you know, the time, the class times and things. And on the eve before giving this presentation, he came up with his own plan. And that's what he presented to faculty. And that's what you voted on. And by him presenting his own plan, which was half-baked and which was not implementable, because he hadn't thought through who would be the people responsible for evaluate, basically, you know, having students write an essay at the end of fall term in December, when is, as you know, an extremely busy time for faculty, that he was somehow mm-hmm. going to get all of the English department faculty to read these hundreds of essays in the last week of December.
The way you describe it, it was like it was designed to fail.
It was designed
it
to
fail. It was presented in a way that was so...
a shit ton of effort into designing something that would have been successful. He threw that aside because he didn't really understand it. And he gave something that he thought he understood. Ignoring the externalities, this is another neoliberal concept, right? I mean, the externalities of having to coordinate with another department, the externalities of costs or resources, or, you know, are, you think faculty are going to grade these without getting an additional contract? Where's that money going to come from? He didn't concern himself with those things because they weren't problems that he recognized. He didn't trust us.
And they weren't priorities that he had.
And they weren't priorities that he had.
He had no direct incentive in seeing you succeed in doing this, or didn't recognize how it would be beneficial to the English department for that to be the case.
Right. So when that vote happened, I realized I'd have to shut down the STAY program, because if I can't get the English department to coordinate with the math department, I can't run this program. And that's what I did. I shut down the STAY program. And then I was, trying to figure out what my next step would be.
And so that was, sounds like February of 2014.
Yeah.
Then take me up to, when was your last official day of work? When did you move out? Your last paycheck?
Bless your heart, Danny. So being the kind of person I was and the kind of work that I did, I had lots and lots of leave time that I didn't use. And if I didn't, there were certain years that if I didn't use all of my leave, they just went away, right? So there were a couple of years in, at some point where I had to take vacation time, like the last 3 weeks of June, because the clock reset with the fiscal year in July 1st. The meeting I just described occurred in 2014, and 2015 felt, the 2014-15 school year felt funny because I no longer had a STAY program to be the coordinator of the STAY program. I still had the AmeriCorps program, but that was reduced. There was reduced federal support. There were reduced federal dollars, and those dollars were drying up, and fewer of our students. Like at one point, we had 250 Adams State students who were enrolled in that program, and Trinidad State. I also grandfathered in all of the Trinidad State students who had been enrolled in the Valley's version of the program before it became an Adams State grant, to only a handful of students who were qualifying for it. So I also had to mothball that grant and close out that program. And I found myself negotiating with my boss, Dr. Mumper, what could I do to continue taking these online, the courses that I took for my EDS, many of them were courses that transferred into the doctoral program that was also at that same institution, at Appalachian State. They have the Center for Developmental Education. It's where I got my certification, my EDS in developmental education, and they were willing to take basically about 24 credits of that existing degree and roll them right into the doctoral program. So I applied to the doctoral program. I spoke in length with Dr. Mumper about, like, how can we make this happen? There had been precedent. There was another person on campus at the time who had a master's degree. He was in a tenure track faculty line, but didn't have his doctorate, and he needed to get it. And the university worked with him so that he could work, he could teach remotely, and be able to attend courses out of state. and continue to maintain his health insurance, his affiliation with the university, his para, you know, all of the little things that happen when you have continuity of employment. And that's what we were planning for me. So, and I had already used my EDS project, as I've already referenced, in service to Adams State. I mean, you and I taught a class together. I did a whole bunch of research on first generation Hispanic college students and what, you know, what are best practices for helping them feel connected for concurrent enrollment. I don't know how much you helped, but like we helped the admissions department figure out a way to issue ID cards to high school students so that they were experienced.
I totally remember that. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean,
we
created the concurrent enrollment process at Adams State because it didn't exist. And that was one of the things I did in service to the university while I was earning my EDS degree. And I intended to
give them a sense of belonging so that they could have a card that gave them membership into the Adams State community when they might be the first person they know from their family, from their circle of friends, who could hold up a card that said, I'm a student at Adams State.
It felt important. It seemed like it meant a lot to the students as well. And who knows? Maybe they don't even probably do that anymore. I know, you know, once you and I were gone, there wasn't anyone teaching that digital storytelling course. But I planned to do the same thing with my doctorate. That's what I had pitched. Which was not compelled of the other person who got all of these releases to get his doctorate. So over several months, between negotiating with the doctoral program director of that program, with my boss, the things that I was trying to get done, we figured out a way for me to be off campus for 16 weeks at a time, to take the in-person classes, because it was so fucking important to do in-person instruction for that doctoral course that is now completely online. And I made the decision, you know, knowing by even leaving for a few months, I could be putting myself further at risk for being employed here. I have to also share there was when I left for 4 weeks in 2012, when I started that program, I came back and Trudy Kretzinger hugged me so hard and said, never leave. You can never leave again. We need you here. You know, like you belong here. We can't have you leave like this. It was a very big deal for me to make.
What was she referring to, or what obligations or what connections did she find lacking in your absence? Because Trudy Kretzinger is not someone from Adams State.
Thank you. Yes. I really felt, and you know, I think a lot of people feel a unique sense of community in the San Luis Valley, a unique sense of family-like structures that are not necessarily based on blood kin, you know, the chosen families that we have. And, you know, I spent Christmas with Trudy's family. I think I've spent Christmas with everybody's family now. I think I've spent Christmases with you as well. You know, being a single person, right. You kind of are an orphan in some people's, you know, in some estimations. And I was adopted. I felt at home. And Trudy was definitely one of the people that made me feel that way. Many people created that sense of community, that sense of that you can rely on each other. That, you know, there's one thing to have a friend or a colleague, someone you work with that you have a certain level of trust and you can rely on mm-hmm. them. But I knew these people would feed me. I knew these people would. I mean, if I ran into hard times, there were people in the valley who would give me a home, give me a place to stay, give me a place, you know, give me the kinds of supports that I needed. And I think what she was referring to was what a great threat it may have felt like for me to not be present, possibly because of the kinds of work that I was doing with the Local Foods Coalition and with the big dreams that we had, and that they have. And I'm really thoughtful of pronouns because I was part of a we that I'm no longer a part of anymore. And it was a we, and now it's a they. And there was a wrenching apart for me to have to leave under the circumstances that I did.
Because you were getting run out of town.
As I was getting run out of town, not in the middle of the night, but in the middle of the summer when you know, it's effectively the middle of the night for people who, you know, kind of check out of their, they don't check their university email. They don't know, you know, if you aren't paying really close attention, you might not have even noticed that I disappeared. And in fact,
yeah, just sort of disappeared, right? You have a box or a couple of boxes and you put the stuff from your office into the boxes and then you turn in your keys and there's a checkout procedure and it's this very weird kind of divorce proceedings that you have with your employer. You start, or at least I started to feel all these bonds that I had formed that just were not reciprocated. And what it feels like to put so much into something. Ironically, Leslie Alvarez said in one of her last lecture, she gave the advice not to fall in love with your job because it can never love you back. And I thought about that a lot during that time.
Yeah. That's an expression my father used. And it's also funny to me because he was a workaholic. My dad was a school teacher. My dad taught music for a middle school music teacher for 34 years. Also raised a family of four children, one of whom wanted to go to an expensive private college, private liberal arts college. And he worked five additional jobs in addition to teaching. He was driving coach buses. He was working in a circus band. He was a fire inspector. He did, he taught summer school. He taught, he was in the Army. He was in the Army National Guard with me. We both served in the Army band together.
It's almost like weird resumes run in your family.
Right, right. And so I when I hear that phrase, I also think of the irony of the person who kind of hammered it into me. I think my dad loved teaching and he was a good teacher. He was, a lot of who I am, at least some of who I am as a teacher comes from, growing up with a parent who's a teacher. My mother was school secretary. I grew up in the schools and it was not a foregone conclusion, but, likely that I was going to go into teaching and that I was going to love that part of it. And I don't know if it was a way of, a cautionary tale of you're not going to make enough money as a teacher to really live by the values that you say are important to you. And, I'm glad my dad was able to retire. He's a baby boomer, of course, and he got to have a retirement party. He got to have, a sense of closure and completion and recognition for the decades of work that, the thousands of people, still, yes. Who will run into him in the grocery store and be like, "Hi, Mr. Lemke. He was my music teacher." Watching generations of children go through your school district and all of those things.
A sense of your a sense of catharsis, a sense of your impact, and a sense of feeling valued for your contribution to your community, for the we that you helped to build.
Yeah. And instead, because decisions were made in the last weeks, as you may recall, in 2015, it was a transition to a new president. President McClure had just been, was about to start on July 1st. And it was President Svaldi's responsibility to clean house, right? He was supposed to do some reorganizations, cut the fat, eliminate some positions so that McClure would, so an incoming president wouldn't have to be the asshole, right? Incoming president gets to have some working money to be able to say, well, what new initiatives can we do? What, I've got a couple $100,000 because we eliminated all these faculty positions or whatever. Mm-hmm. Tell me how to spend this so I can start building my administration and doing the work that you hired me to do. So in that time frame, my position was eliminated, and it was so close to the end of the fiscal year that I didn't have I had more leave time than would have been possible for me to use in those 2 or 3 weeks.
How did you find out? Did you get an email?
Oh, the way that I found out is. There was an equity retreat that we were, it was one of, I believe, a Title V equity retreat. It was held at the Bacon Ranch, you know, out on the billionaire land in the west or east part of the valley. And it was glorious and beautiful. And for the few days before I got this email, and on like the Sunday of that retreat, I got an email, or Saturday of that retreat, I got an email saying, I need to meet with you at 7:30 on Monday morning. So I guessed that it was probably a termination meeting. And I went home and I typed up, you know, here's everything I've done. Here's what I could do. Here's what I'm planning on doing. We had these agreements that I would be working remotely, that I would go to part-time and be able to keep my health insurance and do the same things that James Doyle was able to do. And none of that mattered, because the decision had already been made, you know, or what, for whatever reason, Novotny was just delivering the news to me. Didn't matter that I had this counterproposal. None of that mattered. And so,
yeah, they don't like counterproposals, right, by the way. Right, exactly. I spent an inordinate amount of time. Well, you feel like you're part of a community, you're part of a relationship, and you feel like what you can do is recognize the need, recognize what the other party wants, and propose something that is of mutual benefit, because you feel invested and you think that they are also invested in you. And it's only then that you find out that you are about as disposable as whatever went out in the, you know, municipal garbage bins that particular week. And then it's it. That's all. So you had a counterproposal. Were you able to be heard out for what you said?
No, not at all. I mean, I brought it. I shared it with, it was a meeting with Margaret and Frank, and they were just notifying me that this is your termination.
And it had already been decided.
Here's how, you know, you qualify for unemployment. So that's good news. And isn't it great? Because you're going to start grad school anyway. Good luck. Bye.
So they used the fact that what you thought, it's ironic, because what you thought you were doing was increasing your qualifications to stay at Adam State. And they used those same acts as a justification, or at least as a kind of a consolation prize as to why you were being removed from Adam State.
Yes. It was the...
And you're like, no, wait, I'm going to that program so that I can... stay here. Like, that's the point of what the other thing that I was doing was. It's not for this other purpose. I'm not trying to leave you. I remember, same timeline, Dr. Mumper and Dr. Novotny saying something like, you know, Adam State has really low institutional self-esteem. And I thought about what that meant a lot. If you have low institutional self-esteem, just like if you have low personal self-esteem, you always assume the other party is about to break up with you. And so the best thing that you could possibly do is break up with them first, because surely they were going to do it to you anyway. So why would you get too invested in any individual person if you're just certain they're going to leave you? And so it becomes a self-fulfilling prophecy. Because you treat people like they're disposable, they start feeling disposable. And then they start acting like they're disposable. And so when they're disposed of, or when you dispose of them, it really just completes the setup that you had been orchestrating the entire time, whether one or both parties was aware of it.
What you're describing is reminding me of like the Recita explanation in the Valley of, as it was explained to me when I started at Adam State. There is a George W. Bush called like the soft bigotry of low expectations. You know, this sense of like, these poor kids, you know, they're lucky to go to college anyway. Why don't we just, you know, and you create a second class, because you are creating a self-fulfilling prophecy.
It's certainly true in K through 12. And what you probably witnessed were many students who fell into that trap in a K through 12 environment, and then it was perpetuated by Adam State.
Dude, we could have a whole nother podcast about, like, for example, students with disabilities who did not in fact have a documented disability, but because of the way their high school experience set them up, or you know, just the interesting sorts of things that I got to experience working with the Grizzly Testing and Learning Center and accommodations, and how it, you know, a theme similar to what we've been talking about this afternoon in terms of an early evening, as the case may be, you know, having policies that aren't really policies. It's not on the books, but this is the way we do it. This is that are totally illegal and discriminatory, or, you know, like, well, we don't have money to comply with the Americans with Disabilities Act. And it's like, well, so then one thing is illegal and one thing is impossible. And which one are you going to choose? How is this going to work out? And how much did we spend on the football team traveling last season? You know, like, how?
Well, it wasn't a problem until you brought it up, Karen.
That's right. That's right. Yes. Complaint creates the problem. And the way to solve the problem is to remove the complainer. Yes.
I mean, I remember both before and after my own Adam State experience in present and in exile was the sentiment that Adam State is going well, people really like it here, there's just a few unhappy people. And if it weren't for those few unhappy people, everything would be great. But what I suspected and then came to found out on my own is that most people at Adam State have some degree of resigned sense of, if I don't use the word suffering, just a sense of low institutional self-esteem. And so the occasional person that might speak out would be regarded as, you know, some noble but inevitably failed cause. Like, I remember a faculty member who's also not there anymore telling me one night when we were all getting drinks together as I was in my foray against the institution that I believed had wronged me, he said, you know, if we were living in a different era, you would be a folk hero. But in the era we're living in, that just won't happen. Like, the recognition that there is a sense of values that are worth fighting for, and the people who stand up to defend things like public land or the integrity of an institution and the way it treats people. But the set of circumstances that we're operating under prevent the right people prevailing on the right causes and getting the sense that we don't always have happy endings.
The system will reproduce itself. And the people who benefit from the way that the system worked, if they were able to navigate the so-called meritocracy to become a PhD and to become, you know, a professor at illustrious Adams State, then the system works because I succeeded within the system. And I, you know, coming back to that idea of not being able to recognize a problem because it doesn't affect me directly doesn't mean that I don't have a responsibility to work to see that problem and work to try to recognize it. But I mean, I frankly have come to see higher education as a white supremacist project. Higher education is a settler colonial project. It is telling the story to young people that if you give us your tuition dollars, we're going to create changes in your life, or at least sell you these credits in such a way that you can, you know, leverage this return on investment to improve your quality of life. And it's a pyramid scheme, multi-level marketing. It is, you know, the people who are most bought into working within higher education have the most to lose from questioning if there's any problem with the way that the system is functioning. Certainly any university that has a football program is going to be able to align their priorities in such a way to design for what students actually need.
What do you have against football programs? Spell that out, because I think I know what you mean.
Okay.
But what do you mean?
I went to Appalachian State University, which I didn't recognize was a football school. So much so that because of contracts with, you know, the television networks, the main parking campus, main parking structure on campus, on the Thursday evenings when they were going to have these televised NCAA football games in the Pac-12 or, you know, whatever conference they're in, they shut down classes, evening classes, starting at 2 p.m. to make sure that everyone would be out of the parking garages. So it's more important to make sure that the NCAA can fulfill its media contract than it is to have students be able to attend their classes from 2 p.m. on for the 7 p.m. game or whatever game time, evening game time. Also, the illusion that sports programs like football and men's basketball create a funding stream that is positive for a university is...
I've heard this before. Yep,
this is the story that makes it make sense for people to create an entire system where the most highly paid public employee in any given state is most likely to be either a football or basketball coach, depending on how the seasons have been going, you know, how when people care about these rankings and things like that.
I always thought when that argument was made about Adams State specifically, as we faced, you know, budget shortfalls and we were looking at where to allocate, you know, limited resources, that, I guess compared to nothing, having a basketball or football program for men was going to be beneficial in some sense for enrollment and recruitment and retention. But you never look at the opportunity cost of where else that money could have gone instead that we don't have a program for, that isn't being funded. And what outcome could we achieve with that? Well, we'll never know because we never tried it. Because we're set and committed to the set of priorities that we have, because that's the way we've always done things. And really, who are you to come along and question?
Right. And as someone who uses feminist theory in my research methodologies, and you know, questioning these structures of power and how gender is used to elevate some and diminish others, the ways that Title IX. Funds are allegedly, you know, being equitably distributed when you have a football team that costs so much more than a women's volleyball team. And, you know, but we have the same number of players on both a men's team and a women's team. And so therefore, we're in compliance with the spirit of Title IX. And if I can just say a little bit more about Appalachian State's fucking football program. And I paid $700 a year in student fees for athletic facilities at that very nice institution. And, you know, part of the story is that, well, you know, if we have this great football team, we'll have these great facilities. But of course, those are restricted only to the athletes that are competitive athletes. And yet, and so in order to make a comparable recreation center, pool, weight room, you build a separate one. And that's what I was paying with my $700 a year, $350 a semester in student fees to basically subsidize an athletic program that was supposed to be the money moving the other direction, right? It was supposed to be some sort of benefit to the entire institution that we, and you know, as far as I'm concerned, or as far as I know, Adams State doesn't have like the big NCAA television contracts and stuff the way that a Big Ten school or a Pac-12 or, you know, whatever.
Yeah, it's Division II athletics, I believe. So it's not right. It's not in that same
right.
sphere.
And yet, the idea that this is, you know, an arms race of having the best state. Yeah. I remember having a conversation with you, Danny, about Porter, you know, the person who donated the money for Porter Hall and how he gave, I don't know, $10 million to Adams State, which was huge, but he gave $150 million to Stanford and his other alma mater. And it's kind of like you and I were saying, you know, what would happen if Adams State got $150 million, and my immediate thought was they would gild the football stadium. That's the way you spend money at Adams State. If you want me to put together a literature review of all of the things about male entitlement of men in those particular sports of football and men's basketball, sexual assault, and correlation with participants in those sports, impunity. As I heard you talking about in the other podcast, the ways that sport athletes can just come to their media studies professor and say, these are the dates that I need to be excused from these educational activities because I have to go play golf. I have to travel out of state in order to play golf. And so you need to accommodate my needs.
And my thought was, well, gosh, why didn't I get on the ball sooner and generate a list of dates the student has classes and have the student athlete go to their coach and say, hey, coach, I have class the following time, so if you could excuse me from games or practice, because turns out I'm actually here to earn a degree.
And Danny, of course, your department chair and the people who scheduled everything in Banner, they already made all that information public months ago. Yeah. You know, it's the power play of being able to, you know, the impunity.
Yeah, or just when I would design classes and look at scheduling when to teach them, one of the first things my department chair, David Mazel, said at the time was like, well, you can't do anything after 2 p.m. I'm like, really? Why? It's like, there's a whole, I thought about how many classes I took in afternoons, you know, or early evenings when I was in college. It's like, well, that's the practice window. The practice window. What's the practice window? Right. But it was like, the practice window. That's when all the students who are student athletes are committed to, you know, practicing for the sport that they're in. So it was definitely early on an understanding that the tail is wagging the dog.
Well, and just to add, there are STEM faculty who intentionally scheduled their labs during, you know, after 2 p.m. to intentionally exclude athletes from majoring in their disciplines, to systematically discriminate.
And let's be honest, not always, but often, student athletes are performing on campus because that is the most accessible means that they can get an affordable higher education at all. And if they weren't there on an athletic scholarship, it's very likely that they probably wouldn't be able to afford to come to college at all. Like, that was their ticket toward upward mobility.
Even that has been nickeled and dimed down to, I think it was like $500 scholarships. People were getting $500 to come to Adams State to play lacrosse or you know, whatever. So there's two things with that. It's an insufficient amount, right? It isn't covering room and board and tuition and travel expenses, books, and all the things that it ought to cover. And when we think of, like, I got a scholarship to play ball at college. But it, more importantly, it is that leverage that you can take to your parents, to your community, and be like, they're going to pay me to go to school. I got a scholarship. I won this competition. They're recognizing me. It's very similar to, like, here's a few dollars, professor. You know, you're getting recognized. You get to carry around your professor title. You get to be, you know, when you go to City Market or whatever, people are going to recognize you because you are affiliated with the university. You get to carry around that badge of honor. Lucky you, we're only giving you 40 grand. You know, we're basically giving you poverty wages in order to, but you get the privilege. You get the prestige, the concept of prestige. And even the idea of prestige in a magic trick. Prestige is the trick. Prestige is the thing that makes you think something has value because other people think it's part of branding, right? It's part of, you know, we're going to tell the story of Adams State as if we're doing all these great sustainable, innovative food study sorts of programs and things. But basically what we're going to do is try to do the cheapest thing as possible with as little resistance from faculty, with the thing that's going to be easy to do that isn't necessarily satisfying the needs that we originally set out to do and isn't necessarily going to help students achieve the things that they want to do.
Well, and the fundamental component of any magic trick, of course, is misdirection, to get people to look in one direction or look at what the right hand is doing while the left hand performs the trick, right? So all that prestige may in fact be part of the magic trick and the misdirection to say, we're going to accord this kind of imagined level of status or appreciation over here, while we, on the other hand, design all these and perpetuate all these systems of inequity on the other end of it while you're looking at the prestige.
Amen. Amen. If I can say one more thing about football, closed brain injuries. Any sure. institution that continues to have a sport that is documented, you know, NFL players are begging, you know, for people to study their brains after they shoot themselves in the chest so that they, you know, they can leave their brain intact. So maybe someone can learn something about these, you know, traumatic brain injuries that are directly caused by playing football. So to me, when I saw that some universities care more about football, you know, about the prestige, the game day, the alumni, and of course, you know, being able to get alumni dollars. But when you sell out to basically damage your students' brains to make bucks, I don't want to work for an institution like that. And
I've just never understood. I've never understood how, if the proposition is that a student sits in a classroom and engages in work in the library and elsewhere, to fill their brain with knowledge and to hone the critical thinking tools that they're ostensibly in higher ed to develop, why would one part of their day be dedicated to that and the other part of the day dedicated to activities that inexorably damage the brain? It's almost like you're trying to achieve a goal and part of the design is actually attacking the same set of achievements. Like it's doing it despite the other thing. It's like, it would be better if instead of playing football, you just stared at the wall, because then at least your brain wouldn't be getting injured or the potential for injury during that same time.
Right. But then you wouldn't get the NCAA television contract, media contracts. And licensing. I mean, I think a licensing is, of course, important part of it. And I think time is going to tell that this COVID, it was pretty much explicit. Wisconsin Public Radio ran articles about how $100 million worth of contracts are on the line if we don't open up the University of Wisconsin this fall. And they did. And they shut it down, of course, you know, rolling shutdowns. But the most important decision factor was whether or not, how are we going to fulfill our obligation to our NCAA contract? Because we can't lose $100 million. They don't care about us at all. It's not safe here. This is not a safe place.
You've had a little bit of benefit of hindsight at this point. You decided to share, my understanding is, you decided to share your story now because you had a conversation with a longtime friend from the Alamosa community who heard that you, I thought you left because it was impossible to finish your degree, but in reality, you were getting run out of town. So why are you deciding to share this story now? And for people listening, what do you want them to know or think about based on our conversation?
Yeah, I mean, Danny, I think even when you started this podcast in around 2016, maybe, I was following it. I was, you know, and I knew you would ask me at some point if I'd be willing to give a podcast. And
it's a standing offer for a whole lot of people that know who they are.
And I appreciate that you wanted to hear my story. And in the first years, and while I was in my doctoral program, while I was working in higher education, I wanted to protect myself. I wanted to protect. I thought, I don't want to jeopardize my LinkedIn contacts. I don't want to be taken out of context. I don't want a misquote. I don't want people to be like, Jesus, she talked that way about her, you know, former institution. Why would anyone ever hire a person like her again? And only recently, you know, realizing it's not a safe place for me. Higher education, as it is presently structured, is imploding, and it should. A lot of institutions will close down. There are a lot of people who are in charge of institutions who, just as we're seeing, you know, the chief executive of a sovereign nation say, I'm not going to go down without a fight. I'm going to fight this all the way. That's what it would be the response if we said, you know, what if we really restructured this university as if Black Lives mattered? What if we really restructured this university so that a person who is working full-time could complete a degree plan in the evenings and weekends or online? What if we really
thought about— What would a Hispanic-serving institution actually look like, not merely one that enrolled Hispanic students or students of Latinx descent?
Right, yeah. Right. And you know, to that point, one of the big things that one of my takeaways in my studying of minority serving institutions in particular and Hispanic serving institutions like Adams State, there are some minority serving institutions that are run by the so-called minorities in that community. For example, historically Black colleges and universities, a lot of the tribal colleges and universities are run by the tribe, you know, the Menominee Nation runs the College of Menominee Nation. The people who are running many of the historically Black colleges and universities are themselves of that ethnicity. And when they see a young person who's struggling with getting their financial aid or getting registered, or they tested into developmental math or whatever reason, they see that young person and they're like, that's my cousin. That's my, you know, that's someone I care about. That could very easily have been me, or it could be, you know, I want to make sure that we fix the system because I don't want that kid to fall through the cracks. And that's what happens at institutions where you have an alignment between the decision makers, the paternalistic, you know, the people who are making decisions on behalf of other people, and the populations being served. However, the history of Hispanic serving institutions, which is a relatively new history, in 2000 was when that first designation, when the Higher Education Act was passed with this Title V added to it, saying we want to give extra money to Hispanic serving institutions to help them grow enrollment and do these transformations that things like Title V have made possible at Adams State and at other HSIs. However, Adams State and most other HSIs are predominantly white institutions. They are mostly white, you know, white identifying administrators and faculty, and they tend to have a more paternalistic relationship with the populations that they are allegedly trying to serve through the Hispanic serving institution. That was a big eye-opener for me to realize, yes, that explains why. I have so many stories. I had a student named Deshaun, D'Shawn. I was trying to get him enrolled in my stay program. Why aren't you in this class yet? You need to be here. How come? And he's like, I'm trying, Ms. Lemke. I went to computing services and they said that they can't make an email address for me. I'm like, what the fuck is that? So I'm like calling computing services. Oh, well, we don't allow for apostrophes in people's names. And I'm like, I'm sure someone named O'Brien or somebody has worked here at Adams State University. You're telling me you couldn't make a username for my student named Deshaun? Now, I'm not Black. I just knew that if I wasn't going to make a phone call to computing services or whatever, and, you know, I'm not saying this like I'm the hero. I'm just saying, oh, that probably happens 100 times a day during new student registration and people are trying to navigate a system. And if you just categorically say, I can't help you, go away. It's not the same thing as being run out of town. Deshaun wasn't run out of town, but he was at the end of his rope because he couldn't enroll in the class that he had signed up for, paid for, moved here, had his parents, you know, take pictures and everything about, I'm going to Adams State. I'm super proud. I'm super, you know, this is the beginning of my adult life. I'm so excited. And some administrators telling him, well, just go away. I can't help you.
Two quick thoughts. The first is, as you described that story, I thought of the concept of self-deportation, which was promoted by Mitt Romney in the 2012 election as his immigration solution. If you make conditions so difficult for a marginalized population, you don't actually have to deport them or evict them or anything of that nature, because through their own attrition, they will leave. You've set up a system where it's impossible for them to navigate, and it's designed that way, then they will self-deport. And whether people are willing to acknowledge that explicitly or not, many faculty, staff, and students at an institution like Adams State will self-deport because it is not designed to actually serve or accommodate them. I shared this story with you, I think, over an email exchange, Karen, but I've not shared it, I don't think, on the podcast, which is around 2012, I got an email from an office in Adams State seeking to get feedback on how to make the institution more accommodating toward people of color, students of color on campus. And I wrote back by saying, well, you know, between Alamosa and Monta Vista, the next town over, there's a sign that is in a field that says, Obama hates America, Muslim Brotherhood not so much. I can imagine being a person of color in a community that has almost no Black people and seeing the sign of the first African-American president, a sign referencing them, as hating America, and then wondering how many people drive by that sign every day. How many people share the beliefs that that sign communicates about America, about what it means to be America, that you hate it when it's Obama? And so I wrote, well, why don't you find a way to get that sign removed? And the response I got was just a very kind of cursory, well, we appreciate your concern, but the sign is someone's, you know, private property. There's nothing we can do. It's like, there's actually a lot of things that you could do to highlight why this is an issue in your community. You know, I'm pretty sure if there were other symbols on private property that had overtly racist connotations, there could be community-led efforts to convince the landowner not to have that sign in that particular way. But the long story short was that office wasn't actually interested in the
confronting bad behavior in
the larger structural problems. What they wanted was an answer like, you know, maybe have a Kwanzaa table set up at the next student organization fair or something that was like the prestige, right? Like, here's the magic trick. Look away from all of the underlying structural racism in this community and appreciate the fact that we're giving you like a token ceremonial acknowledgement of some superficial aspect of your culture, your ethnic identity, or something like that. Yeah. Those were the things in my head as you described that.
Which it itself is a way of marginalizing you further, because it's not like a recognition. Like, one of the things I'm reading is about departments that have an idea of the Western canon being the core of their curriculum. And you and I have both been affiliated with English departments for whatever reason. And that's a discipline where you have generally older, whiter male people who believe that great literature is Shakespeare and you know, a bunch of other so-called dead white guys. And that anything where you're trying to introduce a Toni Morrison or, you know, some other representative of excellence is some sort of activism on the part of social justice warriors and those crazy feminists and uppity people who don't know their place, because, you know, whiteness is really what the curriculum is, and you cannot penetrate that by me acknowledging that it's something other than whiteness. And there are some scholars
back in a big way this year with the Trump administration insisting that all those ethnic studies programs are teaching children to hate America and must be removed.
And I think you know, reframing it as the deficit is in this mindset. You know, the whiteness studies, as it were, examinedness of whiteness studies is the deficit model. You know, the truly robust study of literature, the study of communication, the study of languages is the more inclusive version. Dumbasses, you know, like all of you people who are tenured and who have, you know, who have benefited from studying a very specific part of the so-called Western canon. My undergrad advisor was an expert on Daniel Defoe and the 18th century British literature and very witty and wry sarcasm and satire. That was his specialty. Very, very traditional conservative view of what not even, you know, only British literature counted. He didn't even count American literature as being worthy of study. I think part of this moment, this threshold that we're on between the old world and the new world and the death throes, literally dying. I hope we close with this. I've been visualizing Valkyries. Do you know what a Valkyrie is? Right, you know.
Absolutely. There's a Valkyrie in the Avengers films who had a prominent role as a woman warrior on horseback.
Okay. So I'm not referencing anything with like made in the past 100 years. Thinking about the Nazi celebrated Richard Wagner operatic.
Oh. Yeah, I'm with you.
Valkyries and the Nordic mythologies on which the Lord of the Rings and the Ring Cycle and all of those historical stories that are kind of constructing, they're constructing whiteness, of course, and they're and a lot of, you know, celebration of a fatherland and things like that. But the role of a Valkyrie in that, at least what I've been reading about Valkyries in the context of that Wagner opera, is they are the angel of death, right? They're flying women, they're witches, who come to a battlefield. And if you are facing a Valkyrie, they're judging you, and they are deciding whether you are going to come with them to Valhalla and drink mead, or to be forgotten on the battlefield. Who's going to win this battle? Who is going to be the hero that that is celebrated from after this battle? And I've been thinking about this Valkyrie imagery because of being on this precipice between an old world and a new world being born. Yeah. There's a lot of resistance to this new plural, recognition of people other than white people, recognition of genders other than male and female, but just, you know, the non-male people are count as well, that there is going to be a lot of friction on this battlefield. And yet these Valkyries that are visiting us and visiting, you know, me in my dream and whoever's listening to this podcast trying to imagine. And of course the Valkyries are also the ones who are wearing like the helmet with the wings on it and the big breastplate, and singing the fat lady singing at the end of the opera. That's the Valkyrie I'm talking about. These are women who are telling men about their bad behavior, and women standing in judgment, and women pulling us into the new world, and us letting go of the old world. And part of me letting go of the old world is part of me letting go of the title of Dr. Lemke and my ego attachments to what that means for me professionally, me getting some recognition, me getting paid that way, me getting to teach people and being called professor, and people, you know, like, holy shit, what does Karen Lemke have to say? She's an expert on this. Letting go of
the... You're talking about detitling women, femmes with doctorates? Is that the...
Yes.
Yeah, great. Okay,
you know,
I'm with
you. Of course, it's important to recognize hard work and the women like Dr. Jill Biden, you know, who have earned the exact same degree that I mean, she has a very similar thing. She teaches at community colleges. She works with underprepared students. She, has looked at best practices for, I think her dissertation was something about best practices for supporting students at community colleges, which is, you know, very similar to what we did at the Grizzly Testing and Learning Center and the STAY program and those sorts of things. And of course, those are diminished because they are expanding participation. There's expanding recognition and legitimacy of people who are not formally recognized as being legitimate and legitimate heirs to the wealth of what America can mean to us. And so I'm going to be a Valkyrie. I'm going to be the screaming harpy, the battle axe, gently and firmly and lovingly bringing us into the new world and serving mead by doing this podcast. This is me answering your question of like, why now?
The Board of Trustees listens to this podcast, and they are so impressed and overwhelmed by what you have to say that they offer you the position of president of Adams State University, starting at a time of your choosing. And they say, recognizing we don't have all the resources in the world, but that all the resources we can bring to bear, they are yours to direct accordingly. What would you like to see happen at an institution you labored tirelessly at for all of those years and all of those discoveries and hardships that you made along the way?
Oh, that was a softball for me to tell you about the Grizzly New Deal.
It might be. I'm glad that you're doing it, because part of me thought you might just answer by saying, we're going to burn it all down because higher education is totally irredeemable we're going to do away
Here's
with
one
it.
Thing.
So answer it however you'd like. So, the floor is yours.
I have actually been looking at real estate offerings for decommissioned schools. Like, there are these buildings, the physical plant of an institution where they have lecture halls and dormitories and commercial kitchens, so you can have a cafeteria service where you could have a residential college experience. And I have done all sorts of, you know, planning. Karen, you know, Dr. Karen's food school that is part of the future of what I think our future needs to look like is family, you know, deconstructing family structures so that single people and young people can be much more mobile in the world, that you can, if you are displaced either because of climate change or COVID situations or whatever reason that you can't be where you are now, or you find yourself newly unemployed or in a situation where you need to create a situation for yourself. I want
you're LGBTQ and your family and has your disowned you. Or some,
yes,
you're a migrant. Yeah.
You are a displaced, an internally displaced person, as we saw during Hurricane Katrina and whatnot. I want systems connected by trains where people can basically move into these food school types of situations where it's a living learning community, not unlike the ways that Berea College and other colleges that have like a tuition waiver, a type of system where you do work study. You come with the shirt on your back and we'll make sure that you have food and housing and an education because you're part of, you are a necessary producer within this community, not a passive consumer, not a customer that is paying tuition and gets to demand what is right. We are all working in this together. It's a reciprocal being in relationship between faculty and students. And I imagine these, I have this, you know, big visions of those sorts of things where people are able to get really a personalized education by being treated like a family member, you know, but like I might live in this living learning community for a traditional number of years, like 4 years, or I might be here for a few months. It might be like, you know, people are traveling around the world or are traveling, trying to find themselves, trying to find a situation that makes sense for them. It might be that they find a home, much as, you know, a lot of faculty hope to do, that is our forever home, where we feel like, oh, I'm going to buy a house here and raise my family yeah. and die here, and this is going to be awesome. Parts of the neoliberalization, like part of undoing the neoliberalization of higher education, is to recognize that if we aren't thinking of other human beings as human beings, then we are really yeah. working in more of a necropolitic. You know, there is this concept of the necropolitic is that some lives are ungrievable. Judith Butler talks about this too. You know, like some people just don't matter. They're collateral damage. I'm going to design this university for people with an ACT math score of 19 or higher and fuck the rest of them. I mean, that's sort of what it boils down to for me. To get specifically to if Adam State at a time of my own choosing hired me to be President Karen, the time of my own choosing would be immediately after they dismantled the football program. And then I would have hundreds of thousands of dollars to work with for me to restructure things around student need. And I would start by doing a asset-based community development by doing asset mapping the valley and looking at what are the existing institutions, what are the ways that people are plugging in and connecting, what are the needs in our community, and how can us as a university or academy or whatever it is that it evolves into, how do we grow from the bottom up from the needs of the people? You don't need a curriculum that comes from the Ivy League. You don't need a curriculum that acknowledges Cambridge University and, you know, stuff that isn't necessarily going, certainly it's, you know, I have a master's degree in English literature. I took my comps in those areas. I've read a lot of fantastic literature, and certainly Shakespeare and many others are worthy of recognition. But the idea that there is a canon that has been established by a bunch of tenured faculty that's going to make any sense to the town and gown is outdated, and I'd rebuild it from the ground up, working with existing assets and doing what I do, right? I mean, what Karen does is builds coalitions, figures, you know, asks a lot of questions. What is it that, what's important to you? What are the system? How do I map the existing systems in place? And what can we do to amplify that to build the beloved community, as Martin Luther King famously said?
So you're saying deciding between 12 credit hours or 15 credit hours a semester being the full-time student threshold is not one of the most important decisions you would make as president of Adams State University.
Well, and
you
know,
bigger design goals.
To that point, assuming that we are going to have federal and state support is underlying a decision about making sure that a 12 or 15 credit hour full-time tuition window is going to be in compliance with those federal policies for grant money, for Pell aid, and you know, a lot of students, myself included, did not apply. I didn't fill out the FAFSA because I knew that I wasn't going to be, that it was going to tell me about loan opportunities for me, but it wasn't going to really be the sensible kind of thing. And it, again, it's a structure designed to make sure that the current faculty who might have expertise in, you know, this philosophy, right? You know, you've got a tenured professor in a department that doesn't really exist on campus. And so you create like a department with seven letters in its acronym to account for it. And so you better at least have a philosophy course in the basket, because we have to justify why we already have these tenured positions. I'm saying this as lovingly as I can make it sound, because I'm continually bought into the idea of higher education and want to support people who, you know, have unique specialties. But when it's driven backwards to say, well, we have a philosophy professor, we have this person who does film, we have that person who does, whatever, and we're going to make a curriculum that's coherent based on where we went to grad school. You know, that doesn't mean anything in the context of the ecosystem of the San Luis Valley in a biological sense, but in also all of the social ecosystems that are present, that you just try to map it over, just like a settler colonial claim, that it is an extension of a settler mindset. It doesn't acknowledge existing relationships. It doesn't acknowledge reciprocity. It's lying on the battlefield, and the Valkyrie is you know, wants to take us to the new world where we can go drink mead and have a better way.
My 12 or 15 credit hour question was a mostly flippant way of illustrating how it seems like most people who get into positions of responsibility have a very narrow window in which to work in terms of the possibility space that they're allowed to envision within. And what you have just proposed with the, what did you call it? The Grizzly New Deal?
Right.
Just thinking about if you were to start fresh and not have to adopt all of the implicit assumptions and belief systems that have underpinned
Danny,
the way.
Wait. I just need to catch you. It's not that this is neutral. It's not that I'm going to reject those systems. I'm saying I have biases, and you know, the things that make me are also related to me having grown up as a white girl in Wisconsin, and the, you know, the different sort of class markers that I have, the different sort of acceptability markers I have in terms of gender conformity and being attractive. You know, I mean, there is way too much benefit that I have experienced as being a relatively attractive person that I carry around with me as part of what made me who I am. And I might be blind to, you know, as we all are, blind to the ways that privilege works in our lives. So it's not that I'm saying that we have a way of getting away from structures of privilege, because we are still working within the system, but we can be intentionally more inclusive, and we could even just target. We could say, you know, we know that food is important, and of course, you know, food studies is what I focused on in my work at Adams State, writing my dissertation about that food studies program. And I, you know, writing about what they actually did versus writing about what I would do and where I am now in terms of thinking about, there are people right now within a mile of me in Milwaukee who are cooking food in their kitchen and serving it to their families and they're also serving it to other people in their apartment complex, or they're driving it over to the church and distributing. So there are informal systems of food preparation and distribution that have emerged because of COVID. I mean, they were always present, but have come to the forefront in terms of food security. Now, what Karen Lemke is doing is I'm trying to figure out ways to help people who are already doing that work get the necessary food safety certification so that they could, for one thing, just to be safe, just to make sure that they don't accidentally poison themselves or other people. But when you get this sort of federal recognition, the USDA, certification, or the sovereign, any sovereign nation can give you a designation. So the Menominee Nations Department of Agriculture could certify the safety of my food as well, being on Potawatomi and Menominee lands, as I am here in the city presently known as Milwaukee, the good land, as they say. That how can I make those little incremental changes for people who are already doing the work, who already have a social structure, who already have a way of of doing the thing that they want to do, and just enhancing it a little bit so that they could, if they want to make money with it, then this is the pathway. They don't have to leave their families. They don't have to move across country. They don't have to, have some divide where I'm educated and you're not. And now my own siblings don't recognize me because I went away to college and they didn't.
Any closing thoughts or anything else that we haven't touched on that you want to give a final reflection on?
Thank you, Danny, for editing whatever this is going to turn into. I know if there's 3 hours of content, there's, five times that in terms of trying to make sense out of it. And I think of Valkyries as editors, too. Valkyries decide the quick and the dead, and there are sentences and, a minute of audio that's worth keeping and a minute of audio that's not worth keeping. And I wish you well on telling this story, because I'm hoping I gave you enough raw material to do something with it.
How does it feel having told this story now that we've sat down and done this after this time?
In one of my last emails with you with planning this, I articulated that, like, I just want to get it over with. I just want to move on with my life. And there's something that continued to haunt me from the valley, the frog spirits, so to speak. It's not that they won't call me back, but I had to make a hard break between, in the same way as we talked earlier about how do you know when it's over? How do you know when the relationship is over? I don't know that it's over, but I'm really pulling back my tentacles. I felt like I had a network that included a lot of people in higher education who worked in Colorado, not just at Adams State, but I also, in the course of my decade-long manic episode there, I consulted with the Colorado Department of Higher Education on their developmental ed policy, which was, again, part of what precipitated Adams State having to change its policies. I thought that I would be coming back to something, and I'm recognizing that I'm going through transformations that might not take me back there, or they might, but I need to pull back all of those tentacles in a way that I'm protecting my energy and being a little seed to be planted in the new world, in the new things that we're building. And I really have a hard time seeing higher education as it's presently configured at Adams State and elsewhere. I mean, I have plenty of opportunities here to work in higher education as well. There has to be radical restructuring before those will be truly equitable or equitable enough that I want to put my energy there. And so I'm either going to build my own things, or maybe some miraculous changes will happen. But I'm drawing back my tentacles from the valley, and this is closure.
Thank you for joining me today.
Thanks, Danny.